Good evening and welcome to the January 12th, 2017 meeting of the Northampton School Committee. I'm Mayor David Narkowitz, Chair of the Committee, and I'll begin the meeting by asking the clerk to call the roll of the School Committee.
Dr. Thomas Baird?
Here.
Ms. Molly Burnham?
Here.
Ms. Rebecca Bujanski?
Present.
Ms. Laura Fallon?
Present.
Ms. Yannassi?
Present.
Ms. Danny Meyer?
Here.
Mr. Howard Moore?
Here.
Mr. Nardi?
Present.
Mr. Eric Hussey?
Present.
And Mayor David Narkowitz?
Present.
Thank
you. So we'll begin the meeting this evening, as we do every meeting, with the public comment session. And I have a sign-up sheet of folks who signed up in advance to speak. I would ask when you come to the podium if you could state your name and address for the record. And I do have a three-minute timer that I'll be using just so that we can ensure that everyone has a equal chance to speak. So the first person who signed up is Jeremy Whalen.
Hello, everybody. I feel like I haven't seen you in years. I'm going to stand up for the night. Jeremy Whalen, 214 Pomeroy Lane, Amherst, Massachusetts. I'm also a technology teacher at Northampton High School. I just wanted to briefly speak about a few things tonight. On the agenda, you'll see the model UN trip to Yale. Really excited about that. It should be a fantastic time. We're taking, I think, 8 students down, and last time I went at Clark University, we had 2 honorable mentions, which was really exciting. I wanted to thank 2 students, Henry and Ruby, for their work on what you'll see tonight, anti-racism poster. They did through a lot of different edits and due diligence, both doing their work in my class and when they had a couple of minutes of free time, they helped me put that together, and I wanted to thank them. I also want to thank the superintendent for putting together a great hiring committee for the digital literacy and computer science position. It was a very thorough process, and somebody in a technology position in our district, I felt that it was a very thorough process, and I enjoyed being on that, and I thank the superintendent for listening to all of our concerns. And lastly, I just wanted to thank the SOCA, Feminist Collective, GSA, and Environmental Clubs for putting on probably the best social justice week I've seen at the high school in my 3 years. Every single day there's been something that each teacher can show their students and discuss on a wide variety of topics. And tomorrow we actually have an intersectionality panel as well that I'm really excited about. We'll be recording that for your viewing pleasure as well. So a lot of cool things going on, and I just want to thank all those individuals. So thank you.
Thank you. Okay, the next person who is signed up to speak is Julie Spencer Robinson.
Hello, my name is Julie Spencer Robinson. I live at 248 Spring Grove Avenue here in Florence, and I'm the president of the Northampton Association of School Employees. I'm here tonight with the association's leaders on the negotiations team, or chapter coordinators. They each have prepared short remarks on the outcome of the association's vote on Tuesday to ratify the 6 tentative agreements. I would like to provide you with some background information about our process. There were 25 negotiators, 23 from the association and 2 from the school committee, who were excellent and outnumbered. In accordance with NACE bylaws, the 6 chapter coordinators appointed the members of their bargaining teams, and the coordinators were elected by NACE members. In October of 2015, I sent Mayor Narkowitz a request to begin negotiating successor agreements to the 2013-2016 contracts. In November and December, as soon as I was released from the classroom, I embarked on a listening tour to learn about the issues employees wanted to see negotiated. I visited all 8 work sites and met with members of all 6 bargaining units. In February of 2016, the association team voted to negotiate as a coalition with all 6 units always at the table together, and your committee agreed to our request to try an interest-based bargaining approach. The entire team was trained in IBB last March, with this philosophy informing every decision we made. I believe that we understand each other's concerns, and even if it is not my first choice, I support this decision because we have fully discussed the interests, explored all the options to address this issue, reached this decision fairly and openly, and because it is the best decision for us at this time. We started negotiating in April, concluded in October, and finished reviewing all of the language changes in December. for those of you keeping score at home. We met for 24 sessions, totaling 70 hours at the bargaining table. And of course, lots of work outside of that. Every decision of the negotiations team was made by consensus, every single decision. And Superintendent Provost and I co-chaired the bargaining sessions, thereby avoiding the cost of hiring a facilitator. Negotiations addressed these areas of shared interest: salary, wages, and benefits, to attract the best employees possible and retain our current staff, raise the floor of our lowest paid employees, and assure fiscal stability for the district over the 3-year span of the agreement. Workload, to address the increased amount of work required by compliance with public education mandates and by new district practices and policies. Contract alignment, to adopt as much common language as possible among the 6 contracts and to extend similar benefits to all employees where logical, and cleaning up contract language. Last Tuesday, 52% of MPS employees showed up to vote on the ratification of the 6 tentative agreements, a remarkable turnout. I'll let the chapter coordinators share the outcomes.
Thank you. The next person signed up is Andrea Ejito.
Good evening. My name is Andrea Ejito. I live at 431 Spring Street here in Florence, and I'm also a kindergarten teacher at Ryan Road School, and I'm the teacher chapter coordinator for the Northampton Association of School Employees. I first would like to publicly express my deepest appreciation to Molly Burnham and Downey Meyer for their excellent work as part of our negotiations team, and to Howard Moore for standing in as a substitute when needed. Thank you to all of you for your hard work and dedication. On Tuesday, we took a vote to ratify the tentative agreement that negotiated for the 2016-2019 contract years. 86% of the members in my bargaining unit who cast ballots voted to ratify this agreement. In voting yes, teachers made a sacrifice and stood in solidarity with the other units in order to raise the wages and benefits of our lowest paid employees while still maintaining fiscal stability in our district. Despite the modest gains for teachers in this contract, I stand here today urging you to the members of the school committee to vote to ratify our tentative agreement at your next meeting. In a time of financial challenges that we all agree are imminent, this contract has many benefits for our teachers. For example, it provides teacher paid work days within the year to meet the added mandates and responsibilities. It provides a time for additional parent and community outreach events. It provides a longevity bonus for teachers who are in our district for more than 10 years. And it raises the hourly wage for curriculum work outside of the regular classroom school day. These are just a few of the added benefits that help soften the financial blow that's dealt by trying times. Thank you for all your support of our children in the city of Northampton and all of the employees. And please vote to ratify this agreement next month. Thank you for your time and have a good night.
Thank you. The next person is Sharon Carlson.
My name is Sharon Carlson. I live at 129 Franklin Street in Greenfield. I am the Vice President of NACE, and I'm here today to read a statement from Kara Dupre, who is the Administrative Chapter Coordinator, as she's doing other administrative duties this evening. She is pleased to report the result of Tuesday's vote to ratify the tentative agreement negotiated for the 2016-2019 contract years. Members of her unit voted unanimously to ratify the agreement. Kara urges the members of the school committee to ratify the tentative agreement, particularly because of the educational increments that honor administrators' continued education at the Master's plus 60 CAGS level and the PhD levels. As educators, we give our children the tools to become lifelong learners, and we encourage that approach every single day. It's only fitting that we encourage and honor our administrators who approach their personal and professional lives in the same way. And we recognize that administrators are not often tied to a desk, as the nature of their job requires them to visit schools, attend local and state meetings, visit homes, and interact with our community. The cell phone allowance and the flexible travel reimbursement recognizes the often unpredictable schedule our administrators have and the necessity to stay connected to their school and district and be accessible to their staff. Kara also wants to thank Donnie Meyer and Molly Burnham for their excellent work as part of the negotiation team. Thank you.
Thank you. The next person signed up to speak is Todd DiGeronimo. Oh, not here. Okay. Okay, thank you. The next person is Robert Rodriguez.
The keys. My name is Roberto Rodriguez. I'm the custodian chapter coordinator for the Northampton Association of School Employees. I'm here tonight to beg you guys to pass the tentative agreement that we came up with. 60% of my unit agreed to it and would like it to go through. As the lowest paid unit in this district, it would go a long way. It would show that you guys are listening to us, appreciate us. We work the hardest, we work the longest. It would just give us some motivation to continue going. I would like to thank Downey and Molly for your compassion, your time, and just hearing us out. It was greatly appreciated. Thank you.
Thank you. The next person signed up is Barbara Rakoska.
Good evening. My name is Barbara Rakoska. I'm 571 Florence Road. I'm a union delegate, and I was on the negotiating team. The chapter coordinator could not be here tonight, Pat Judd. I'm happy to report that the cafeteria unit voted 100% to ratify. They were pleased with the hardship pay for inclement weather when there's a two-hour delay. The cafeteria staff doesn't get a two-hour delay. We need to be in there to feed the children when they finally get there. Where they were also pleased with a clothing allowance. We are on our feet on cement floors, and that goes a long way for supportive shoes or anything else we need. Also, we got some more holiday pay. Making the language equal in all of the contracts really puts us on equal footing with all the other units. Pay raises for workers that are at the top of their step. There are people in who've been there 25, 30 years that once they hit step 8, they're stagnant. So this is very important for them to get these pay raises. Like to thank Downey and Molly and Howard for stepping up to the plate and allowing us to negotiate this way. It was great working with all these people and learning how each unit works and just knowing the support we get from each other, which is important in a school system, that all the units support each other, from cafeteria to teachers to its administrators. It really showed us that we meant something. It was just, I want to thank the bargaining members. It was amazing to bargain this way. I have been in the union and bargaining the old way, and we got nowhere. And the teachers, and they all gave up a lot to give us lowest paid workers something. It was great. Anyway, I'm hoping that this contract can be ratified. I really do. We all worked very hard on it, and I think it would be great for the city as well as its workers. Sometimes we disagreed, but it was never disagreeable. It was great. Thank you.
Thank you, Barbara. The next person is Laura Briggs.
Good evening. My name is Laura Briggs, and I'm the parent of a Jackson Street School student. I'm also a UMass professor and the author of several books on Latino studies. And I'm here to speak on behalf of putting something in the student handbook speaking to a sanctuary resolution. And more importantly than any of those things, I am also the adoptive parent of somebody whose parents were born in Mexico and who we lived in Arizona at the time that SB 1070 was passed. And I know what it means for young people to live in a time when immigrants are scapegoated. And I've been in that place as a parent. And in the last election, of course, immigrants were primary scapegoats. And whatever we think about the outcome of that election, the reality is that we have immigrants and other people who might be seen as immigrants in our school district. And it seems to me incredibly important that we say to them that they are welcome in our community and they are welcome in our schools. What happened after the passage of SB 1070 was not just that people who were in fact legally vulnerable as a result of the what people called the Show Me Your Papers law, it wasn't just that undocumented people fled. It was all sorts of Latino immigrants fled. And they pulled their kids out of school and they stopped applying for things like food stamps that they were eligible for or Medicaid. And if we don't stand up and say something affirmatively about the value of these kids and these families to our community, then we do them a disservice and we run the risk that that experience will be repeated as Donald Trump becomes our president. I also have had the privilege of communicating with Superintendent Provost about this issue, and he suggested language that affirmed what the Department of Education and Department of Justice had said in the past. I would speak against that because that's just a floor. And I think many of us suspect that Department of Justice under Sessions or the Department of Education under DeVos may change those affirmative statements about the protections immigrant students have in our schools. And I think it's very important. I'm not going to speak to specific language, but I think that it needs to be affirmative. It needs to be simple. It does not need to be legalistic, but it needs to affirm the value of all our students. Thank you.
Thank you. The next person signed up is Jennifer Nye. Oh, there's Jennifer.
Jennifer Nye, and I live at 49 Prospect Street in Northampton. I am the parent of a first grader at Jackson Street School. I'm also an attorney who practiced immigration law, and I'm currently a faculty member at UMass Amherst, where I lecture on law and social justice issues. And I just wanted to also give my strong support for the committee adopting some sort of a statement in support of immigrant students and families. I know there's been some controversy nationally about whether you use the word sanctuary. I'm not necessarily invested in that. I think the most important thing is that students who are immigrants, families who are immigrants, particularly students who might be targeted as immigrants, even if they're not immigrants, might be read as immigrants, that we create an environment where people feel safe. And I think that that needs to go beyond just citations to Supreme Court cases, which there happens to be a good Supreme Court case out there about the right of immigrant students to public education. That's great. I hope that doesn't get overturned. But people don't read Supreme Court decisions. I know that as a professor trying to help my students not be intimidated by Supreme Court decisions. So I think citing it is great. If you want to append it, that's great. But I think what we're really hoping for is some sort of language within the handbook that would be in non-legalese that would talk about how immigrants and immigrant students are welcome here and that this is a welcoming and affirming community. I know our principal, Gwen Agna, is really wonderful about putting forward those kinds of vision statements. And if those aren't already in the student handbook with regard to immigrant students, I would ask that the committee consider some language like that to say that we welcome those students and those families and that the school district will do everything within their power to support those students and to also outline what those specific things are, that we're not going to be giving students' names to the police or to ICE, that we're not going to be handing students over, especially if there is not any sort of legal documentation. Right now, there is a department, I think it's from the Department of Justice, it might be from Homeland Security, saying that ICE is not supposed to go to schools. I hope that that continues to be the law. I'm not sure any of us know what's going to happen after the 20th, but I would encourage this body to think about what kind of language we can put forward, or the Northampton School District can put forward, to really support and tell immigrant students and families that we're going to stand in solidarity with them, and that we're not going to be participating in making spaces unsafe for them, because I think that it's important that all of the students in school feel safe and that all of the families feel safe going to school. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Okay. That is the list that signed up. Is there anyone else who wishes to speak who did not sign up?
May I add one thing?
Sure.
I just want to thank Laura Judd also for all the time she put in our negotiations in the evening she's been here.
Thank you. Thanks, Barbara. Okay, so that... thanks, Laura. That concludes our public comment period. Are there any announcements from members of the school committee? Any announcements? Okay. So we'll now move into recommended actions, and we have the consent agenda this evening. It contains the approval of minutes of the Rules and Policy Subcommittee meeting of December 15th, 2016, the negotiating subcommittee meeting of December 21st, 2016 and January 4th, 2017, the curriculum subcommittee meeting of January 5th, 2017, and the rules and policy subcommittee meeting of January 5th, 2017. We also have transfer approval for water and sewer budget transfers to realign accounts. And then there are several field trip requests: the NHS Model UN, Yale Model United Nations, New Haven, Connecticut, January 19th through the 22nd, 2017, the Prevention Coalition CADCA Conference in Washington, D.C., February 6th through the 9th, 2017, the Girls Ice Hockey Co-op Game at Newington Ice Arena in Newington, Connecticut, February 17th, 2017, the NHS Outing Club, Savoy State Forest in Florida, Massachusetts, March 3rd through the 5th, 2017. The 8th grade Latin students going to New York City, May 4th, 2017. The 8th grade Spanish students going to New York City on May 4th, 2016. And the NHS senior class going to High Meadow in Granby, Connecticut on May 31st, 2017.
Motion to approve the consent agenda.
Second.
All those in favor of the consent agenda, please say aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed? Any abstentions? Okay, the consent agenda is approved. The next item on the agenda is the vote to set our 2017 meeting schedule. I believe Laura provided a copy of that to you. Are there any questions or concerns about that? Otherwise, Ms. Busansky.
Sorry, I'm trying to pull it up here, but I noticed that I think it's the second February date is during school vacation, so I didn't know if that was an issue for anyone. I'll be away that week, but maybe that's not a problem. So just wanted to point that out.
Okay. Any other questions or issues about it? Otherwise, entertain a motion for the vice chair.
Okay, a motion to approve the 2017 meeting schedule as presented.
Is there a second?
Second.
Okay. Any other discussion? All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Any abstention? Okay, so the school committee schedule for 2017 has been approved. Thank you, Superintendent. Next on the agenda is the report from our student representative, Elena Fragamini.
Hi, everyone. Happy New Year. So at NHS, students are currently finishing up our first semester. We're really busy preparing for finals. It's also Social Justice Week at NHS, as Mr. Whalen mentioned. Each club of our social justice clubs, which are the Students of Color Alliance, the Gender Sexuality Alliance, Environmental Club, and the Feminist Collective, get a day of the week, and each choose a specific issue to tackle on their day. Friday, tomorrow is Intersectionality Day. This will examine the overlaps between identities such as race, class, gender, sexuality, and also the overlaps between the movements that each of the groups cover themselves. There will be a panel during the school day with a variety of local activists, and all questions for the panelists will be from NHS students. Those questions have been gathered throughout the week. As part of Social Justice Week, the Feminist Collective is doing a menstrual supplies and diaper drive in partnership with Safe Passage. Donations can be brought to the front office at NHS. Many students at NHS and their respective clubs and organizations are preparing for the arrival of refugees in Northampton. Specifically, the Mayor's Youth Commission has been looking into a variety of ways they can help out. The academic team won their match on as Schools Match Wits, which is a televised quiz bowl competition. They are now headed to Nationals, which will be held in May in Atlanta, so congratulations to them. The theater department is participating in its first traveling theater competition. In early February, a theater competition will be coming to the area, and students will be performing the play Antigone. And the Northamptons had two very successful performances at First Night in Northampton, so congratulations to them as well.
Thank you very much. Okay, the next item on the agenda, we have a vote, a gift, accepting a gift from the NEF SOS Book Fund. Okay, and we are going to have our liaison to the NEF board, Ms. Fallon, make that presentation.
Thanks. The Northampton Education Foundation would like to make a gift from the Support Our Schools Book Fund. This fund provides per capita grants to each Northampton public school for the purchase of library books, textbooks, and educational materials. Each school council decides how its allocation will be spent. Contributions to the book fund come from an annual appeal sent with the city census and the spring plant sale. This year we have raised $17,921 for the book fund, and we would love it if you would accept that.
Okay. In past years, Joe Bartolomeo has come and made that presentation. He's been a longtime member, and of course, some of you know Joe just was a three-time champion on Jeopardy. So maybe he's on a press tour or something. Sorry.
Live large.
So, but is there any questions about that, or is there a motion to approve that?
Make a motion to accept the gift from NEF SOS Book Fund.
Second.
Okay. And again, for folks watching at home, people who go to the plant sale every year, that's one of the major, that's one of the fundraisers for this fund, as well as the census drive, the envelopes they get in the census. So,
yeah, and there's a lot of work that goes into that plant sale, and they're always looking for volunteers.
Exactly. So, yes.
Anyone's interested.
Yep. Okay, so all those in favor of accepting this wonderful gift, please say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Any abstentions? Okay, thank you very much. The next item on the agenda is a vote for student handbook revisions. And I believe we're having three of our administrators this evening, Principal Cannata. Are they going together or one at a time?
I think one at a time.
One at a time. So,
okay.
What's that?
We're together.
Oh, you're together. Okay. So Sal Cannata is here, Kirsten Champagne, and Associate Principal Malvezzi is here.
Good evening, everybody, and thank you.
Caitlin, I'm sorry, mangled your first name. It's his writing, I'm sorry.
Good evening, everybody, and thank you for letting us speak tonight. So in the spirit of consistency and to demonstrate our commitment as a unified K-12 district, we're here tonight representing all six Northampton public schools and to propose an addition to our student and parent handbook. So working within our school councils and knowing the other three schools, the other elementary schools, respective school councils' views on this topic, it's been agreed to that adding the information from the fact sheet from the U.S. Department of Justice and the U.S. Department of Education, the Office of Civil Rights, to our school handbooks, and we think it's a good idea. I'm assuming that you have this paper that Laura submitted. And I think it's safe for us to say in our state and our region, certainly within this community, that we respect diversity. We pride ourselves on acceptance of all people. We're progressive, vocal, and visible on the issues of civil and human rights. We believe that the school should reflect the values of the community, and it's safe to say that within our schools, our diversity is our strength. And all six schools work tireless every day to create safe, welcoming, and engaging communities where everyone is welcome. Thankfully, these values and federal laws are clearly aligned, and this is captured in the opening paragraph of the document that you provided copies with that we're going to call the fact sheet. Would you, one of you care to read the opening?
Go ahead, Caitlin.
Oh, thank you. Okay. All children in the United States are entitled to equal access to a basic public elementary and secondary education, regardless of their actual or perceived race, color, national origin, citizenship, immigration status, or the status of their parents' guardians. School districts that either prohibit or discourage or maintain policies that have the effect of prohibiting or discouraging children from enrolling in schools because they or their parents' guardians are not United States citizens or undocumented may be in violation of federal law. The rest of the document references acceptable enrollment policies as well as policies that cannot be used to deny a child an education.
That's what we
have. Ms. Malvesi, do you have a...
Well, I don't have anything to read.
Sorry. I just...
But I, you know, in the meeting with our school council at the high school, of which Elena is a member, you know, really, I think this was... it was easy to say, yes, we want to add this to our handbook. There's certainly no harm in adding this, and there's only good that can come of it. I think, you know, all of this is in response to concerns, real concerns of students and families in our district, you know, about the their safety in our schools, their ability to enroll or maintain their enrollment membership in our schools. And so I think anything that we can do that's outreach to share with those students and families, give them information about their rights, their legal rights, and just to assure them that they're welcome and safe in our community and in our schools. You know, if this is a step in that direction, I think it is. I think for us that seemed like the biggest no-brainer. Sure, add it, and then, you know, anything else we can do on top of that, we're open to that as well.
Are there questions from members of the school committee? Any questions or discussions about this?
I make a motion to accept the or approve the student handbook revisions as presented this evening.
Second. And again, just to review for the public, these revisions were discussed within the context of your school committees, school councils rather. As part of okay, so
every
those
school council.
Okay, excellent. Okay.
So yeah, so I just wanted to ask whether this is a first. I would think of as a first step because there are like LA Unified School District has gone further in defining its relationship as a public institution that obviously has to comply with laws, but that does not have to take up the task of, you know, federal immigration, for instance. So I'm just wondering, what are the next steps that the district is contemplating? Obviously, as a public institution, you should do so carefully and with respect to what your community desires. I wonder where we are with that.
Sure.
Dr. Perlis.
As you know from the communication I sent out prior to the meeting, I've recommended placing a great deal of emphasis in the district on compliance with the Supreme Court decision in Plyler. And I think the reason for that it really relates to, I guess, my own reading of the tea leaves and my own anxiety. I think that it is a wonderful act for districts to define their role with respect to law enforcement agencies. In fact, we have memorandums of agreement to do that. But respectfully of this group, I think the force of the Supreme Court of the United States carries a great deal more weight. And the other thing I think is important is this is not new law. This is not some, you know, crazy left-wing agenda that could be overturned by changing of Congress or even changing of the presidency. It would really require rethinking of all of the precedent that went into this. So I think that that was sort of the emphasis of sort of putting the first stake in the ground on the basis of constitutional law. But then I think in terms of next steps moving forward, the other place where the district is already very clear and I think maybe can communicate to the community better is the safeguards it takes with student information. Because I think the sort of next firewall, if you will, after the Constitution are students' records privacy requirements. So, you know, on the one hand, if we were asked to produce a list of all undocumented students in our schools, we couldn't do it because we don't collect the data. On the second hand, we couldn't do it because we don't turn over student data. And so I think really clarifying that for the community and clarifying for that for our students could be reassuring. But then I think that over and above that, it's the spirit of the district and it's the environment that's created in the schools. I would reference Elena's presentation tonight. I think creating, you know, I approach the issue of the handbook from a very legalistic perspective because I think it's important to lay out what families can expect and what they can't expect in terms of the district's treatment of their student and their privacy. But over and above that, it's what environment does do the teachers create, do the administrators create, do the other students in the schools create in order to make all students feel welcome. It's part of the reason why we wanted to get some information out to the community regarding our anti-racism education. Not that, you know, a poster solves the world, not that a policy solves the problems of the world, but to the extent that we can provide multiple opportunities to reassure the public and to reassure students that every resident is welcome and that we will educate all students who show up at our doors and we'll treat them all with the utmost of dignity. I think that's sort of the direction. You know, it's I can't say that we'll ever produce a document or a statement in a handbook that says, okay, we're there. You know, but it's an ongoing process. And I think this came to us because students had communicated concerns to their administrators and to their teachers, and the school councils wanted to know what was something they could do to get started to sort of define the rights of non-residents or non-citizen students. And so I think this is a really solid way of starting by saying, look, you have a very powerful trinity of organizations, if you will, supporting you. Department of Education, the Justice Department, Supreme Court of the United States. I think, you know, not that that will be.
City of Northampton.
City of Northampton. I think that given the tenor of news that you hear every time you turn on the TV or the radio and the dialogue that are sometimes reproduced in social media or regular media, it's a process of reassuring that's going to have to be ongoing. But I do think this is a really solid way of starting.
Yeah, I mean, I think the holistic approach, because the last comment about reassuring, I think there is so much misinformation about what the government will do. Our president-elect makes statements about what he will do that have no relationship to the law. And people hearing those things, which are widely publicized, it creates fear. And so the district, I think, is important for us to just a constant process of education to make people understand what our values are and what we'll do as a district and as a city.
I actually have two questions. The first is, because I have no idea, are we being careful to make sure that our handbooks are being translated into every language spoken by every student in the district?
We do not do that.
Because this seems kind of pointless if you can't read English. The people who most need to be reassured, I'm saying, wouldn't have access necessarily to this.
Under our policies, we're translating into Spanish. Languages currently spoken in the district, I think, number upwards of 11, soon to grow.
Do you think it's possible to have just this information sheet translated into each language and posted maybe on the website?
Absolutely.
Okay, so that was my second part, was is it possible to post this on the website in those languages? Because I know how expensive translation services are for an entire student handbook, but it seems like if this information is going to reassure the students who need it most, it should be accessible in their language. That is all.
Okay.
Just to follow up what you were saying, I think also that our amazing administrators would have hard copies of those, since so often it's really face-to-face interactions and families coming in or families dropping their kids off quite quickly and, you know, car loops and things and you know, doing due diligence. Our administrators are the outreach, are the first line to help families, and so that there is a hard copy or there is somebody who will speak it to them also.
Anyone else wish to comment?
Mr. Moore,
sorry.
I don't know if it makes sense in this particular context, but I think it might make sense to add to the list of agencies that could be contacted, something like the State Attorney General's Office, and the Department of Education, as well as the city.
So are you offering that as?
I don't know what this is. Is this something we're voting on? Is it a proposal from the council?
Okay.
So.
Okay.
Because as I recall, we don't actually approve student handbooks. We simply review student handbooks.
Okay. So you're reviewing with a suggestion. That's a suggestion.
Suggestion.
Editorial suggestion. Okay. Okay. So there's been a motion made by the vice chair. And motion has been seconded. Any further discussion on this? Okay, all those in favor, please say aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed? Any abstentions? Okay, so thank you very much again. Thank you. Okay, the next item on the agenda is a presentation from Northampton Police Chief Jody Casper on the High Five Friday event. Chief?
Good evening. Thank you so much for having me here. It's late for me. I don't know who gets you guys out of the house after 7, but happy to come out and talk about High Five Fridays. So this is a program that was implemented in December in the school district, just in the elementary schools, in the 4 elementary schools that we have. We're very good at naming our programs exactly what they are. We have a park and walk program. You can imagine what this is. And this is a High Five Fridays. So on Friday mornings, we give kids high fives at the elementary schools. So we've rotated between the 4 schools, and that's what our plan has been for one school, one Friday through a month. So that means that each elementary school will have officers there at that school once a month. So we have about 6 more times, I guess, that will occur this year. And so I guess I just want to tell you kind of where it came from and why we're doing it. Shortly after Ferguson, the president signed a task force. The task force findings were put out in, May of 2015. And they said, you really need to do more with youth engagement. You need to have your officers having more positive contacts with members of your youth population, really more positive contacts with members of our entire population, but recognizing the particular value of developing relationships with youth was definitely emphasized in one of the action items in the report. So this report came out. It's a book. It's like, I don't know, 70 or so pages. And it's got a lot of action items specifically for us on how we're really supposed to be doing this job of policing. Certainly, we're supposed to be doing it differently than it was done, 30, 20 years ago. There's a lot of new challenges and a lot of new recommendations on what we should be doing. So born out of that was High Five Friday. And it was a program that our two captains attended the International Association of Chiefs of Police Conference. And this was one of the presented programs there as an idea of a youth engagement program. We liked it because we thought it would be easy to implement in our community. It was definitely youth-oriented. It was inexpensive/free, which we always value. And it was something that we thought would be good for both the students and the officers involved. So we implemented it. We, of course, first reached out to Superintendent Provost and explained what the program is and how it would go. He then reached out to the involved elementary school principals, some of whom I saw here, and everyone gave their thumbs up, and then we initiated the program. So Friday mornings for about 15 to 20 minutes, our officers, including our SRO, our school resource officer, Josh Wallace, go to the schools and high-five kids as they come in. one of our concerns was certainly that there may be kids who might not high-five a cop. I understand that. So the officers are told, you know, don't chase down kids and make them high-five you. You just stand in a line on one side, and kids can pass by without high-fiving if they want to. We also understand that it might be concerning to see a lot of police cars in front of the school when they arrive. I know that the principals were very thoughtful about that, and they took the time to put it in their newsletters to say, just so you know, like, if you see cars and cruisers there, it's going to be High Five Friday. I know they made efforts to announce it the day before in each school. And we also park our marked units very far away from the main entrance, so it's not as, you know, it wouldn't be intimidating to have all those cruisers there. So they've gone off so far very well. We've gotten great feedback from kids. We have posted some on our Facebook page, a lot of parents saying this is great, our kids love it. We had one of our officers who attended one of the High Fives was at another event, and these two kids came up to him separately and said, oh my God, you're the cop from High Five Friday, and like then they talked about their favorite book. So that's exactly why we have it in place. Like, just it provides a quick, easy, albeit brief, but a positive interaction with a police officer that people might not normally get. Unfortunately, a lot of interactions with our officers and all officers can be negative, and we certainly don't want that to be true for kids. We'd love to start off on a positive note. So High Five Fridays is that. And we have put this in place, as well as a number of other community outreach programs that target youth. We have a fishing derby that we did this year. We have a police day where we invite kids and families to come to the station and try on our outfits and everything else. So we've been doing a lot in the area of youth engagement. We have another program down the line coming out. So we're looking forward to our youth engagement. So that's my overview of High Five Friday.
Are there questions from the school committee about, yes?
I was just wondering, is there any youth-specific anti-bias or racial awareness training that your officers who go into schools or do the High Five program go through?
We just finished, actually I just posted today on social media, our training from last year. Actually, our highest rated training category, our officers spent 755 hours of training on bias-based policing. So we don't restrict it just to our school officer. We expose that sort of training to all of our staff, but also our school officer does go to particular trainings regarding issues within schools, and certainly some of that is around race.
Okay, thank you.
Yep.
Yes, Ms. Burnham.
I guess I really appreciate that you've come here. I really thank you for bringing this to us, because I think that it sort of came up very suddenly for a lot of us, and that was a little upsetting. Mm-hmm. Saying that, I think that one of my questions is that I feel like I actually have no idea if it's working. I don't know what the rubric is. I have kids in the school. You've given me anecdotal evidence. And I feel very, okay, what is the goal? How do we assess it? I mean, we're a school system. That's kind of what we're doing. Mm-hmm. And to just say, some kids saw some police officers, and, you know, I can't quite get my teeth into it.
Mm-hmm. I think a lot of our community outreach programs are hard to measure the impact. You know, what is the impact of going to police day or seeing police officers in a parade or anything? I mean, it's hard to measure impact without doing a really widespread sort of survey on that, you know, and I don't know. I don't know what the impact is. But we know from just the brief feedback that we're getting, be it social media or a few interactions we've had, that it's been positive. But right. How do
right.
you measure that?
I mean,
right. Yeah.
You know, it could be neutral.
Could be.
Elena, then.
Okay. So one of the things that I was thinking about when I was hearing about this program is that I do recognize that it comes from a place of wanting to have positive interactions and positive engagement. And this may be a bit more specific to older students of my age group in the high school. Are those positive interactions and programs also coupled with the tougher conversations? Are there any programs that you're working with to have police go into schools and actually have tougher conversations about some of the tougher issues?
Oh, yes, absolutely. So this is elementary schools. We're not working on the tougher conversations necessarily with elementary school students. We're working on just having positive interactions getting familiar with police, seeing police officers as members of the neighborhood, seeing them interacting with other kids and being kind of friendly neighbors, right? That's kind of at the elementary level. When we move upwards into other schools, certainly, you know, we have Officer Wallace, who is our school resource officer, who engages in different types of programming within the school, targeting all different topics, be it impaired operation or bullying or choices around, sexual assault and domestic violence. So those conversations are had there. Additionally, our department offers a lot of different sort of opportunities for people to come to us and learn if they want to have those conversations. One of the ones I can think of is that we offer a one-night class on use of force, which I think is probably one of the most, like, one of the biggest issues with police community relations right now. And so we offered that once, and we had a good full class. People learned a ton from it. We learned a ton from it as well. It was a really good mutual learning experience. Then we offered it again, and there was no interest. So we do things to offer people. The Citizen Police Academy right now is open for registration. That starts in a week or two, and that's a 7-night class on Thursdays for people to come and learn about us. And again, it's pretty mutual learning. Like, we learn a lot when we teach courses about topics too. And we're always out doing lectures and sitting on panels, and happy to have those harder conversations. So I think we offer a lot of different opportunities for that.
Thank you.
Yep.
Mr. Mott.
Having just gone through my unannounced lockdown drill at my school and hiding in the closet with my kids, I really think it's important for, you know, as part of education, it's being aware of what public institutions that are going to play an important role in your life do. I mean, this is, we take kids on field trips. I take them to the Franklin County Jail and to the Franklin County Courthouse. And, you know, the police are an important public institution. And to leave them out, to have the only contact be a negative contact, and that's, you know, what the 21st Century Police Report says, leaves people with a bad impression of police and actually leads to more harm when people encounter police. And so I think that, you know, a thoughtful interaction like this, and obviously it's calibrated depending on the level of the school, is a positive thing. And I would hope that we would encourage it. And again, if we hear that there is some negative effect, that we reflect. And I think that that's happening on both sides. So, you know, I hope that we don't say, because we can't measure it, we don't do it. Because there are lots of interactions that we encourage our students to have that we don't, again, that we say education is not only valuable when there's a measurable result. And so I hope that we support this going forward.
I guess my only concern is that, you know, with so many things that we do in the schools that we get negative feedback for, it's from very educated, passionate parents. And I feel like this is a program that you may be getting positive feedback, but it may be really difficult for people who are having a negative reaction to come to you and say, it really upset my child to come to school today and see the police because the police have been at our house 3 times this month. Do you know what I'm saying? I feel like in this one particular instance, you may not get that negative feedback, and that concerns me, that it's hard to explain why the police would be an upsetting fixture at a school. And so I'm just ambivalent about it. So I do hope, I expect that it wouldn't come to the police that we're not comfortable with you being there, or the superintendent, but that would be the principals or teachers hearing about it and conveying it to us. So I hope that if there is any negative feedback in the community that we hear about it, because that would be, I think that would be really a shame if kids are being traumatized by pulling into the parking lot and seeing police cars. So that's my only concern with the program, is that we may not be hearing those voices who are having a negative reaction to it.
I'm sorry to go again, but okay. I also just want to be thinking about this in terms of what we were just talking about with sanctuary, not choose the word sanctuary, in terms of putting the language in regards to safety of immigrants in our schools, in our handbooks. And I'm also just concerned for the student who may be an immigrant, may have been taught to be fearful of police, to show up at school and see police at the school, and how that would feel about entering a school where you might be genuinely afraid for what might happen. So I just want to be balancing what we're thinking about here with what we're also considering in terms of our handbook policies.
Mr. Meyer.
Sorry to go again, but again, one of the things that is clear is that undocumented immigrants are victimized by crime because of their fear of going to the police. And again, if our police, you know, and I think that the Northampton Police Department is extraordinarily professional and is, you know, working actively to make itself as good as it can be, continually educating themselves about these kind of issues, that's something that we need to educate our students, right? We don't want to just say, because you're fearful of police, let's just have no interaction and let you remain fearful. I think that, you know, yes, you need to be sensitive, and I understand that, you know, you don't want to say, because we're not getting any reports, that the absence, right, that just means everything's fine. But again, if you make it clear that these are the Northampton Police, these are representatives of your community, they're drawn from your community, you know, your chief is someone who was born and raised in Western Massachusetts, went to the same high school.
Attended one of the four high schools.
Yes, yes, which I now teach at, have the privilege of. And, you know, if you make that clear to them that this is not the federal government, right? And again, because people who see all law enforcement agencies as doing the same thing and having the same goals, that's a misapprehension. And I really think we need to actively educate our students about that truth, because they're not the same thing and they don't do the same jobs.
I was just going to add that, you know, one of the reasons, the primary reasons why in 2014 I issued the executive order, well, people say we declared a sanctuary city. It was a little more complicated and nuanced than that, but really it was about trust with immigrant communities, that we wanted people to feel like they could come forward to the police without fear that they were going to suddenly be tripped up into some federal issue or immigration issue. Because we were hearing from members of the immigrant community that they didn't feel comfortable, like if they got stopped and their taillight was out or something like that, that they were going to suddenly be turned over and deported and all that. So that was one of the primary reasons we did that, so that people would have that trust in their local police force. So
I know that Elena had something to say.
I just want to make sure, like, this is great. I just want to make sure that we're balancing the positive interactions with the education, because if there isn't the education that police are a fantastic thing to have in our community, if there isn't the education that children, you are safe around police, then that interaction isn't going to be a positive one if there isn't that base of education.
And then I, to Downey's point, I mean, I was a teacher during DARE, and we had Officer Zane Ange come to our classroom once a week. And I do think that there is something different about walking through a hallway and just high-fiving people. It has a certain goal. You've said what the goals are. It's a very casual interaction. You will see these police officers out on the street. They might high-five you there. They might not. I kind of disagree. I see it as maybe a social interaction, but I don't see an educational piece, except sort of, oh, I recognize this person, I'm high-fiving them. But I don't see it as, it doesn't have the depth that I see that you're describing, Downey.
I mean, I just on the way to work heard an NPR piece about, it was a Washington State Police Department that was assigning its young officers the task of just going and having conversations.
Yeah, I heard that too.
And you know, some of the conversations.
Conversation. That's not just high five.
No, but what I'm saying is, this is not just High Five Friday, right? This is a comprehensive effort by the police department based on a report from the Justice Department following after, you know, race riots in a city that had a horrific record of police. Policing and injustice based on race. And so if this was just about High Five Fridays, I would say, oh, well, okay, that's kind of nice. But again, I don't know why a positive social interaction is dismissed.
I'm not dismissing it. I think it's an important thing to discuss.
I'm not dismissing it. Yeah, we're discussing it. I just want to be on record as supporting this and other initiatives that try to make, you know, educate, and I think the education has to happen. But I don't want to say because there's a possibility that some students might be apprehensive, that we call full stop. That's, and I, that, and that was my concern, is that was brought to us as, you know, because there are students who, and who might be very fearful because they might, right, it might, and again, this is the idea of maybe it was immigration, maybe it was a different agency that carried out a raid, that they would think, you know, Northampton police, I need to hide. And so, yeah, I don't, I just think we should, I or at least I'm expressing a desire that these initiatives continue.
Mr. Reed.
So, first of all, I just want to really thank you for your coming here, but also for your intent, because I think that's your intent in this program is what we all need, is the sort of breaking down of barriers and people getting together and figuring out who is what people's perspectives are. And so I think that, that what you're trying to do is exactly what we all need. And I think everybody's perspective here is valid. And I'm assuming that the superintendent has talked to you about some concerns that have been brought up in the community about maybe undocumented folks or people of color who have had unfortunate experiences with the police who would find this concern. I mean, I'm assuming you're already aware of that other side to the to this situation.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
We tried to approach it as cautiously as we could, recognizing that that may be the case for some kids, and that's why, you know, I reached out to the superintendent. We had conversations. He reached out to his principals, and it was discussed within the school, and we, my understanding is that some of the schools had a system so that if you wanted to use another door or something, you know, you could avoid us if need be. I don't know if that was used, but I understand that that is a concern, and there may be some children who are afraid of the police. But to reiterate, that that is exactly why we're there, and to, you know, it's in some cases it's as quick as a high five. In other cases, I know on our first one, it morphed into the cops going on the playground and playing with all the kids and like playing tag and stuff. So that it's not just as simple as a quick, meaningless. You know, it can be longer, it can be shorter. And to be quite honest, we were very concerned about impacting time on learning. We understand that. We don't want to insert ourselves into the school. You know, this was a pre in the school type of event that we thought would be least intrusive, and that was our intent when we, you know, thought this would be a good fit. It won't cut into children in their academic learning time during the day.
And I just, you know, I feel uncomfortable for you as a person of good intent, feeling like uncomfortable when you go to the schools that because of the way I'm dressed, people might fear me or dislike me. So, you know, I kind
that's
of
my feel job every day, whether I'm in school or not. So that's okay.
And it's unfortunate. And I mean, I think that the people who feel that way, they have legitimate reasons, or what they have their reasons. And what you're trying to do is to break down those kinds of sort of superficial decision making. So, I just, you know, I feel for you, and I feel for the people on the other side of this equation. So I guess, you know, my next question is what you talked about is sort of going into basketball is whether as a next step there's any value in you and the superintendent having another conversation about whether there's sort of, you talked about relationships and there are those who might say, you know, a smack on the hand isn't a relationship, it's a sort of superficial thing. So, you know, things like basketball or playing on the playground or sort of doing what the VINs do. I'm sure you're stressed for staff time, but it does make me wonder whether there's sort of a next step that would be more of this sort of, you know, has an educational value or a more relationship building value that could sort of be something that, that we talk about going forward.
Yeah, and we've been open to that in the brief conversations that I've had around this. We're certainly open to it. As I said, if any school wants to invite us in, we will come in. You know, but that was our concern, was I don't want to have an impact on learning time, you know, academic learning cut into the day. So if we are invited into a school, we always go. I'll read Dr. Seuss, or our officers will come in and play ball, or whatever it may be. That's fine. We're happy to do that. It's something we enjoy. It's good for our officers as well. Almost as good for our officers as it is for the students. So we don't get the opportunity to have a lot of positive interactions either. So it's good for how we feel about our community and hopefully how our community feels about us.
Ms. Hennessy?
Thank you. And I will say that there's a way that I'm very mixed about this. That's wrong. I'm positive of what you set forth to do. But with respect to the schools, I do feel that when I think about the administrators, this white community of leaders, and we're making decisions, and I do think it's incumbent upon us to see how communities of color are feeling before we embark upon this. And we didn't really, but since it went forward, and again, my son loved it, and it could have taken the whole day, and he would have done it. I do think it's incumbent upon us now to reflect with communities of color actively and say, hey, you know, Molly and Ann and, you know, whatever. They loved it, but what was at stake for you and how did it go? Because I feel like I'm almost looking in a fish tank and making these decisions, and many of us are talking about communities that we're not checking in with there. And so I don't know if it worked. I know it worked for my daughter and my kids were talking about it, but I'm sure that there were some kids who were afraid and some families who were afraid, and so let's check with them. I think that's our job, that's not your job, but I think that's what we need to do. Does that make sense?
Dr. Barrett?
So I would echo that, but maybe add something to it. So we don't know, but it could be that kids who were upset, or for those kids who were upset, or parents who were upset, they may have been upset in December, but may not be so upset. I don't know that. I don't know that anybody can know that. But I'm wondering, could there be some type of follow-up? I don't think a survey to everybody would be appropriate, but perhaps like some focus groups or something like that, where we could gather some information. I'm thinking more later, towards the end of the year. I don't think it harms anything by giving it some time and then seeing if there is an impact.
Anyone else? Well, thank you, Chief.
Absolutely.
You know, if you want to start a Thursday night high five, you're welcome anytime. Thank you, Chief.
Thank you so much for having me. Appreciate
okay.
it.
Thank
you. And the principal for the Dr. Seuss thing, too.
Yeah.
Right?
Okay, so the next item on the agenda is a presentation on the district's anti-racism curriculum. Turn that over to Dr. Provost.
Presentation may be a little bit ambitious for what I want to talk about tonight. I just have shared with you a poster in your materials that is the product of the work of really the entire school district, as well as several of our students. I think Elena may have been involved with this at some point.
I did a few spelling corrections. Okay. That's really the limit to my involvement.
I think it's, again, sort of, it speaks to the concerns in the community. Shortly after the election, I was approached by some parents wanting to know what exactly it is the Northampton Public Schools does to try to educate students about issues of race and to try to prevent racism. And I'd say that's a really good question. I don't think we have a comprehensive accounting of that anywhere. So I asked the principals to meet with their staff and identify what are our practices for trying to combat racism and educate students. The first cut at this, I think, was interesting because there was quite a difference between elementary and secondary teachers. At first, the response from a lot of elementary teachers was, well, what do we do that isn't supporting anti-racism? And really, the secondary teachers went more towards content and what courses, what units, what subjects cover topics of racism. So the second iteration of this was I kind of reshared the information that the principals had collected. And I think the elementary teachers kind of maybe got some ideas or reframed and tried to put a little bit more of a shape to what it was they did to combat racism. And then we had a sort of first draft of this poster ready about a week ago, which we then distributed back to the faculty and said, okay, this is what we got from your list. Is it right? We got, I think between 63 and 80 responses saying, no, that's not exactly what I meant to say. All those edits went back to the students who have then sort of gotten it to this stage. I think there's some more work to be done on it, but I think it's important. I think it's important if parents ask us, what are we doing in the Northampton public schools to combat racism, to have an answer. And I think this is something we probably will want to replicate with other areas of curriculum, but I think right now the real critical need is to be able to communicate to our parents what parts of our curriculum address racism. So this is sort of where things stand right now. Our goal when we get this, I don't want to say finalized because I know it'll change and evolve over the years, is to share this throughout the community. I see this in schools. I see this, you know, in public spaces. I see this as a resource for parents who want to know what Northampton Public Schools is doing. But you know, it's much more than the poster. I really think what came out in this whole process was the spirit of the schools and the spirit of the teachers. And you know, there were some really lively discussions about what should be in the poster, what shouldn't be in the poster. We had an opportunity to interrogate some of the issues around racism and some of the perspectives about subjects people were teaching, and was this really anti-racist education, was it not? I think that one of the comments I received was, you know, what I'd really like to know as a parent is, so you have all this anti-racism effort going on in your schools, but what's different about Northampton as compared to anti-racism efforts taking place in other districts? And you can't really put this in a poster, but I would say the spirit that came out during the process. It was really, really, I think, gratifying to me to see, I just put the question out there to teachers, what are you doing to try to combat racism? And sort of the overflowing of responses of people. And it was clear to me that it's a topic that's very much on educators' minds from kindergarten or preschool through grade 12. And everyone wanted to have their subject represented. Everyone wanted to talk about what they can do in their classes to try to support this effort. So I just wanted to share that with you to give you a heads up that when we get this finalized, you'll be seeing it around the schools and around town, hopefully.
Ms. Hennessy.
Yeah, John, Dr. Provost, I've said this a little bit to you. For me, I love the process, and I want to be clear about that and the work people did. I'm struggling with the word anti-racism education in this, because I think that this is, what's listed here is great responsible teaching, responsible curriculum, and it's fantastic, but it's not anti-racist. I feel like that's an active commitment to something bigger than this. These are great entrance points to perhaps have PD and train teachers and have more active work done on anti-racism. And I think even the phrasing that, and again, I don't want to be the wet blanket or negative, but this is how we talk about, when we talk about racism and anti-Semitism and prejudice in our curriculum, and what some things we do to ameliorate that, but anti-racist education, I would welcome it, and I think that there's so many entrances here. But I think that needs, I really believe that needs to be teased out more in this. Mm-hmm. So,
Mr. Reed?
I think that was very well said. The other thing I noticed is that this is really heavy on the actual curriculum, and I know that because my children have experienced it, that maybe it's not a regular part of the curriculum, and maybe it ought to be, but that there is social emotional work that's going on. I'm pretty sure that my younger son got bystander training at Bridgestone School that was transformative, and I think that's what you're talking about, is it's not enough just to have the materials. It needs to be part of the teaching. And I think to a large extent, it is part of the teaching, and that something like bystander training, which teaches bystanders to speak out when they see bullying, affects anti-racism, anti-homophobia, all kinds of bullying activities. So it's active. And then also you brought up PD. I mean, we have, unfortunately, a predominantly dominant culture faculty, and I know that we're making efforts to work on that, but I think that also means that we do need PD that is constant to make sure that we don't have materials that are insensitive, that might be slipping through just because people aren't aware of their role in the dominant culture. I would hope that we could somehow embed more ongoing work, but also in this poster communicate the ongoing work that happens all the time that already exists. Mm-hmm. So.
Other comments? Ms. Burnham?
I really appreciate the work that's been put into this, and I think it's such an important thing to begin a discussion on, and it's a scary thing to talk about as well. And I really appreciate the faculty and who were engaged in this process very, very much. I think I want to be a wet blanket, if that's what it is. Like Anne, I think that it's, I think that there's some things, I won't say much, but I think that I really would like more PD. I think that some of the language is really kind of, I guess I'm going to use the word simple. Say no to racism is a and the image, I just get a lot of different things on this piece of paper. And I know that people are working really hard, and I'm saying this with profound respect, that it is really hard to do this. And if we're going to do it, I would really like us to, I appreciate the time that has been taken.
Okay. Ms. Fargamini.
I also just want to agree with Ms. Burnham and Ms. Hennessy, and I think that when we do this conversation, we also have to think about what we're expecting our students to come out of our district with. And there's a difference between having them come out of the district knowing that slavery existed and having them come out of the district knowing that every black life matters. There's a difference in that, and being able to implement that in their everyday life and real anti-racism, anti-bias work. And I think that as we do this, we have to think not only about what are we expecting our teachers to teach, but what are we expecting our students to know and practice.
Mr. Moore?
Yeah, I was going to say, I think that, chime in with I think this is good to have a start, because I think conversations about race don't happen precisely because they're so incredibly important that people are afraid to have them. And they're afraid to have it for really good reasons. You know, you can, almost anything you say about race will hurt somebody inadvertently. And so it's really hard to have a conversation in a way that is productive. At the same time, not having the conversation just perpetuates all of the hurts that could be touched by having the conversation. So it's a tough thing to start, and I think it's a good thing to start. And there's sort of two levels at which the conversation, I think, has to happen. One is, I think so much about the curricular level, and maybe everything has changed since I was going to school, but you know, I've read some books since I was in school that...
good to hear.
That if I could have read while I was in school, and would have given me a much more accurate depiction of, like, say, history. So I'd just recommend a local production, you know, The Slavery in the Connecticut River Valley, which details, you know, the extent of people being owned by other people here. From really the very beginning of the Commonwealth, and being sold, there's some amazing stories in that book, and But that's the kind of thing that I think it's very easy to live in Northampton and not know, even after you've been well educated in our schools. And not a hard thing to teach. I mean, it's a straight curriculum. It's just history. It's true. And so I think we need to make an effort to really include that in our curriculum. I'm reading another book right now, The Half Never Been Told. I don't know if anybody else has read it. It's essentially a very detailed history of slavery in the United States as it really engaged in the whole political and economic sort of development of the United States. In a way, again, that we don't get in our traditional history classes. And so I recommend reading some of those books. There's a book I read a long time ago by somebody who used to live here. Why Do the Black Kids Sit Together in the Cafeteria? Another, I think, a really good book. It, again, makes some really good points that, again, it was pretty easy to not pay attention to if you're not doing it. And so that's all on the curriculum side of things. And then on the other side of things, it's just the conversations about actual race and how and feelings about race and the impact on each one of us of the fact that we live in a society where race matters in ways that we don't think are fair. And I think those are the much harder conversations to have and the ones that I don't know how we can do that other than to let people know that we hope we can have these conversations in a civil way. I don't know that we can particularly have the conversation, you know, like school committee meetings. But I think if we don't at least acknowledge that those conversations aren't being held and that they would be really valuable to have, I think that's what we should do.
Ms. Busansky.
I want to say thank you for pulling this together because I agree. Well, I also want to say at the same time, I agree with what Ms. Burnham was saying about sort of how the framing of it in that top section. I also found the image maybe a little bit not maybe really appropriate for what this is. But I really do appreciate the content of it. And I thought it was it answered questions that I've had. I know I've even asked you about what are we doing and to really be able to see it on a grade by grade level. I agree that it's a first step and it has to just one piece of the puzzle. And there's a bigger puzzle. There's a professional development discussions, everything. But I really do, to me, to be able to read the content of it from kindergarten all the way through the student groups and events was really useful because I had no idea, and I'm sure that lots of parents don't. So I really thank you and everyone who put their time into it. I'm curious that when it's all finalized and done, and I'm sure there's going to be changes made maybe even after tonight, but how's it, what's your plan? How's it going to be disseminated? How's it going to be used?
My first plan of attack will be to disseminate it through the faculty. Many of the comments in the 63 to 80 responses that we got while we were working on revisions is, I can't wait to get this up in my classroom. So I think that'll be the first place where kids and parents are likely to see it. But then I'd also like to think about getting this out first electronically, but also in physical format throughout the community. So I think in the usual places where we advertise things about the schools, we'll want to have mm-hmm. something that talks about what we're trying to do around issues of racism.
Ms. Fallon.
Just as the liaison to the Northampton Education Foundation, I just wanted to say that was not reflected on here, but there are some projects that we funded just this fall that I think are very relevant to this. One of them being promoting racial literacy in our school, which is a professional development opportunity for up to 20 teachers. And then also the Sojourner Truth's Florence, a walk through history that talks about social activism in Florence in the 19th century. So they're not listed on here, but there are other things I think that are happening in the school that probably would be considered more anti-racism that weren't on this, because I think that promoting racial literacy was really that was the goal of that particular professional development. So,
Dr. Baird, and then Mr. Reed.
So, you know, I find myself sitting here in this conversation not really understanding you know, what's anti-racism, what's culturally responsive teaching, you know, different terms that are being used. And not that it's not something that we don't work on, we do work on it, but anti-racism in particular is not a phrase I'm as familiar with, so I'm interested to learn more about that. And just echoing a lot of the sentiments, I really appreciate this being a real student-included project. I think this is exactly the kind of thing that would be perfect for kids to be involved in. And just speaking as a former AP Stats teacher, so I look at that description, I think, yeah, that's exactly what we did. Like, we explored conditional probability through the Titanic survival data. Like, how likely are you to survive based on what class you were on? But I think that might even be a stretch to really feel like that's culturally responsive teaching or anti-racism. It's a good way to explore data and have a good conversation, but I don't think it rises to that.
Mr. Reed?
So I don't mean to muddy the waters, but yes. It's, you can be the wet blanket and I'll be the water muddier. But I'm wondering if really what we're talking about is not just anti-racism, but anti-bias, because certainly there are ways that we're combating bias in the schools, gender and disabilities and all kinds of things. So just sort of throwing that out there. And then secondly, as a former magazine editor, I feel like I have to say to the kids who designed this, who are possibly gonna hear this and feel pain, that I think they did a wonderful job of design, and that I would hire them. So, you know, kudos to the kids who put this together.
I just want to give a quick shout out to our Students of Color Alliance, who have done some awesome work this week in our Social Justice Week and putting out a video that discusses the differences between being non-racist and anti-racist. So that work is being done specifically at Northampton High School, and I will send you guys the link to that video if you would like.
That's great.
Okay, so any other discussion on this? So thank you, Mr. Superintendent, for making this presentation. You got some great feedback tonight. And, understandably, it's a work in progress, so continue to work on it. So the next item on our agenda is a report from the Curriculum Subcommittee, as well as a vote on a course realignment, and I'll turn it over to the chair, Mr. Meyer.
So we had a double-barreled curriculum and policy subcommittee meeting, and what was presented to us were changes in the requirements for history and social science coursework at the high school for graduation. Our system changed our requirements in order to be ready for an MCAS test that never arrived. So as a result, we are now out of compliance with the mass history and social science frameworks that we are required to teach. So we met with the chair of the history department, history and social science department at the middle school and the high school, as well as Nancy Cheevers, the curriculum director for the district. And they have been doing a lot of work around choosing a pathway for our students beginning in the middle school and running all the way up through high school, in order to first and foremost give them a solid grounding in history and social science, and then second, to make sure that they comply with the frameworks as they stand now. So we had a good discussion, and at the end we voted to recommend that this committee adopt those changes we would ratify the changes in the high school graduation requirements. There was one thing, an issue that came up, which you have a piece of paper in front of you, the legal opinion, which was what would happen to students who were disadvantaged by the midstream change. So students who started out their high school career, or even you could say started out their eighth grade career, where they would have to take one of the courses that would sort of the sequence of courses that would be required, and felt disadvantaged by that. So there was a discussion of some sort of hold harmless language in the policy, and this this legal opinion says that, you know, again, such a claim would be difficult to make, but ends with, however, it is within the realm of possibility. So if we are worried about the realm of possibility, then we should write our policy carefully to allow our administration to make allowances or make adjustments where necessary for an individual student who clearly has met the goals of the frameworks and the goals of our education in Northampton, but may not have met the letter of the policy requirements for graduation.
So I had a question, but I don't know if now is the right time.
It's fine.
So I apologize, I wasn't able to make that meeting, but was there any discussion about like a phase in or like starting with a class of such and such?
Yes.
It's not appropriate in this instance?
Oh, it is.
Okay.
It is, yeah. So, right. So I think, Mr. Lombardi, if you want to explain the rollout, because, yeah, there was a thought as to year by year how whether students would have already completed part of the coursework in the sequence, and those who had not, how it would impact their schedule and how to make the best adjustment.
Thank you. Nice being here. So the requirement change would not change the required three courses. It would change the courses they actually take. Currently, the three courses they take, one of them must be required a U.S. history. Early modern history is recommended, and the third class would be an elective. So the rollout, we feel like we could handle class of 2020.
The current freshman or 2020?
Yes, so 2020 and 2021. But at the same time, we feel we would like to start with the current freshman and not just wait for next year's eighth grader. Reason being is that we feel it's educationally sound that the new requirements that we're going to have now will guarantee that students will have U.S. history from early U.S. up till modern. Currently, on the new system, on the old system, they stop at around 1877. So we're going to ensure that they have the full range of U.S. history as well as a comprehensive world history, and really putting it all together in our own U.S., the relation between U.S. history and world history. We feel that we can do it with the current class. I've checked our current course offerings that students are taking this year. All freshmen right now, every single one has taken early modern. None have doubled up and taken a U.S. history. So with two histories left for our current freshmen, one of them would be U.S., which is one of the requirements that we're going to add. Next year's class would be the recommended World History II. We do not feel that there's doing any harm to anybody. We feel that it's educationally sound, and again, to the curriculum and education you're going to get. As Downey had mentioned, if there were some students that for some reason had can articulate a very clear educational path they were choosing in regards to wanting to have that third history be an elective, we would sit down and listen. However, this does not take any elective off the board for any student. Students still will have 14 options for elective classes, and that can be any of the history electives that we're going to have. So that answer your question?
Ms. Busansky.
So it would not take any of the current electives off the board? So you'd be able to offer this sequence, these three history courses, to every student?
It would be a sequence. Yep. They have to take the classes in order, but they can take it at any time, one during their high school career.
Mm-hmm.
The current graduation requirements, we require 18 courses. So this is not changing that number. Mm-hmm. It's still 18. So of the 32 total credits for graduation, 14 still remain electives that you can choose for more math, more science, more histories, arts, music, theater. That's still there. It's just really about, you know, looking at our course catalog, talking to your teachers, talking to your parents, talking to guidance counselors, and taking a sense, where do you see your path going as you plan the classes appropriately through high school?
So, but within the history department, the teachers would be able to you'd be able to offer these courses, because I assume it's more kids taking these three courses.
Yes,
would shift the balance from other electives away from
taking
offering
things
other
off
electives?
The board and adding. So early modern history, which is the recommended course, mm-hmm. for example, that's going to that is about 10 sections right now. That'll be about 10 for this. Mm-hmm. The World History One that they're taking, I mean, the U.S. history they're taking now, that will just slide into the U.S. And then a combination of some electives and modern world will be the one in the middle. But we do feel, and sitting with Todd Hunter, that we'll be effective, we'll still be able to offer the rich electives we have. Some electives might have to go to every other year, but that's not a bad thing. You know, as we're, again, educationally sound to ensure that the core curriculum that students are taking, they're having access to the full range of U.S. history and world history. But we'll still have the APs, and if you, and I'm not sure what you have in front of you, this also offers sophomores a honors level world history, which they haven't had before. So if you're a sophomore, you can meet that requirement now with the new World History 2, AP Euro, or mm-hmm. honors world history.
Got it.
So there's some other options there that pop up for students as well.
Thanks.
Okay. Any other questions? Mr. Meyer, would you advance the motion on this?
Yes, I'll make a motion that this committee ratify this change in, well, we only were recommending the change in the curriculum. So it's not to us to make a motion other than to recommend a change in curriculum or ratify the change in curriculum.
Okay. We had a vote, right? There is a vote.
Well, just the right realignment.
Yes, this is just that we are going to provide the resources for, you know, if there are resources going forward necessary for realignment, which there was discussion of cost, and it was thought that there was not going to be any significant cost to this, but I know it's up to the rules and policy to actually vote the change in requirement, so we're just giving it a thumbs up.
Okay. So there's been a
motion to give a thumbs up to the change, the change in curriculum at the high school.
Motion's been made. Is there a second?
Second.
Okay. All of those signify saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Okay. Opposed? Any abstentions? Okay. And I believe you can stay at the podium.
Yes.
The next item on the agenda. Does that conclude your curriculum subcommittee report?
Yes, it does.
Okay. Thank you, Mr. Meyer. Next, there's a presentation from Principal Lombardi on the Holyoke Community College on-site dual enrollment.
So I'm here to pleased to share with you that this next semester we'll be offering our first time ever dual enrollment opportunity on Northampton High School campus. We have a relationship with GCC and HCC for students to take classes there for dual enrollment. We have about 10 to 15 students that partake in that in each way, Greenfield and Northampton. But obviously having it in different communities, a travel of half hour, 20 minutes, can cause some students not to partake in that. So we've been speaking with HCC. We already have a dual enrollment line item in the budget. And we made an arrangement that we will purchase and pay for the salary of one professor, and they'll provide the other professor to offer two classes on grounds. We're going to be offering cultural anthropology and intro to health careers. They will be on site starting on January 24th and January 25th. They will be from 2:15 to 5 o'clock weekly until about May 24th. Right now we have about 40 students that have signed up for this. It is free of charge for students. They do need to purchase any course materials or books, but it's free of charge. Requirements are 2.5 GPA and passing the ACCUPLACER, which is a college readiness assessment for reading, writing, and math. And HCC is coming to our high school to administer that as well. We're really excited for it. I think it's going to offer, again, these 40 students who might have been thinking about accessing college but maybe were inhibited by transportation, or for some students that maybe transportation was an issue but maybe they were nervous to leave school and try it on a college setting. So we provide opportunity for students that might have had transportation issues, but we also provide something in an environment that they're comfortable. Where they can maybe get a sense and have some success that they're capable of taking college-level classes, get credit here, get credit for college, and hopefully pursue the next steps after high school.
Dr. Baird.
I'm just curious about the supervision of the instructors and, like, who their actual employer is. So I'm assuming that stays the college, and the college becoming, like, the dean would be coming here to
We have, we're meeting, Lisa and Giordano, the guidance department chairperson, and I are meeting with professors next week. I mean, clearly they're still supervised officially evaluation in regards to HCC, but we're going to be communicating, sitting down with them, and kind of talking what is the difference between high school and college. Some of these professors most likely have had some high school students in their classes, but they're still on a college campus and college-age students. So, you know, what will that look like and feel like? So we're going to talk about our students on the campus at Northampton and what to expect and kind of communicate that way.
Dr. Provo.
They have asked for an employee who's familiar with the student body to remain on site while they're teaching. Yeah. So we will be providing that.
And yeah, and that time frame, I was there till 6 tonight. And so there's always someone there. You know, 2:15 is right after school. So there will be between my administrators, we'll have people available, without a doubt.
Is it open to enrollment from outside of high school? So it's not, this
it's
isn't.
Only Northampton High School.
So it's not in their course catalog, so somebody from the public couldn't
no.
enroll in the class?
Specifically Northampton High School students.
Okay.
I have a couple of questions. First of all, as a teacher in Massachusetts, will this instructor be required to be fingerprinted?
It's a great question. I mean,
I know we're going through it in the district
yeah.
where I am, and we had this discussion as well. And
yeah.
the understanding would be that the faculty member would be fingerprinted.
I taught at GC and HC, and I don't remember being fingerprinted when I did that.
I know GCC doesn't require
okay.
it, but to come into a district and into, you know, into our district.
Yeah, good point.
You
yeah.
know, might be something
yeah.
to look into. Also, it's an after school program from 2:15, and it's going to meet a couple times a week.
Just week.
Once a week.
2:15 to 5.
So a student that's enrolled in that class, that would be one of their four classes that they'd be taking at the high school?
Yes.
So
we do have some students who are taking it as a fifth because they're interested in it, and it's not going to allow for early
so
graduation.
If a student's taking four classes, then conceivably they'd have a free block during the day.
Yep. Just like an internship or a work study or a Smith College class.
And mm-hmm. where would that student be during the day? In the library or leaving campus?
Mine
or?
Is sleeping. She doesn't have a first
so,
period class.
Yeah. I'm not sure how East Hampton is. So when I came from a different school, that blew my mind because they are at the mayor's house. They're in the library. but that's the thing that happens. So anytime that a student has a work study, an internship, it's not always at that period of time. You know, so a student might have a work study or an internship after school, but because that counts for a credit, they might say, you know what, I want that to count toward period one. I'm going to sleep and I'm going to come in for second mm-hmm. period. Or they might want it to be, listen, the classes that I want are only running these periods, so it'll be third period when you count it, or it'll be fourth period. So it allows flexibility of choices. Sometimes the Smith College classes might be in different times of the day, work studies, again, internships. For this case, it's after school. So it gives students some flexibility to think about how their daily schedule looks like.
I'm wondering if there was any thought of having the instructor come in during the regular school day for those students that might not be able to stay after school and participate in a program like that.
Space-wise, that would be a challenge. Also, in terms of this teacher,
well, like a teacher that might have a prep period, for example, their room might not be used during that period. There may be an opportunity.
2:15 to 5 is 2 hours and 45 minutes, weren't 85 minutes. So it would be, I don't have teachers that have in the same room, so it would be.
Right. Well, I guess that's why I was asking about whether it was a couple days a week. And no. I get, that's just a different model. I know, yeah. Again, I don't like the conversations about different districts and how they're doing it, but, you know, to allow a student to be able to participate in that in a nearby district, the instructor is coming twice yeah. a week and is able to allow the student that might not be able to have that opportunity after school to have it within the school day and not have to travel. As you noted, that was one of the reasons that a student may have been prohibited from being able to participate because of travel.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, Yeah, I think that's something. It's, you know, they're offering something. We're working with that. I think I also don't know what it would be like contractually bringing in outside people teaching classes during the school day, and how that would be, honestly. So I'm not sure if that would be an issue. I mean, yeah, that's just me. Word on the street, that could be something. I think that, again, what we're seeing, though, is that, you know, we have 40 more students that are signing up. So that's going to bring our total for dual enrollment, potentially, of having that experience to about 50. So that in itself is success. We're excited to see how this works, and I think that's great feedback. I think it's something to think about. But from having nothing on campus to this, I think it's a home run.
Other questions, Dr. Baer?
Do we have to approve this? Or is this just informational?
I think this is informational.
Yeah, just an informational. Other questions, other feedback?
Oh, I did have a question. So the offerings, the two offerings, what the courses were going to be?
Cultural,
what they were going to be, yeah. How did that come about as far as what the offerings were?
Through it can't be courses that we offer in the school. And it was what the professors there, what they could offer us, looking at in terms of entry level, what was appropriate for that, for the dual enrollment opportunities they have. So we're also trying to find
student input as far as what the student might want or have an interest in, but rather what the specialty of the instructor was.
It was one, finding an instructor that could do it, right, that was willing to do it. Was also the, again, it can't be required areas of subjects that we offer. So typically students are taking things more in, I guess, a liberal arts vein. And also finding something that would be a good introduction to a dual enrollment into a college course setting. We wanted guidance in the school. We're looking for the intro to health careers, because that was a nice way. We find a lot of students typically are going to HCC thinking of nursing, thinking things like that. So we'd be trying to give students those opportunities that might be thinking CNAs, nursing, stuff like that.
Ms. Fallon?
Did you already say, is this only open to seniors?
Juniors and seniors.
Juniors and seniors.
Common question. I love it. I think it's great.
Thank you. Nice.
And then two, doesn't Jeremy Whelan offer a class that also has credit for HCC?
Yes, he's worked something out.
Articulation agreement.
Yeah.
Okay.
The thing that we offer.
Yes.
And because it's met criteria for them that they can say, yes, if you take this, if you come to HCC, yes.
Awesome. Thank you.
Yeah.
Great.
So I think it's a great working model. I think it's establishing relationships. I think it gives us a stronger relationship we had before. I think it can only grow if this works. Thank you.
Have a nice Thank
time.
You.
Thank you.
The next item on the agenda is a vote relative to the student services director contract extension. And I believe Dr. Provost will, or I can describe it, or you can describe it.
If I could not have the high school principal disappear.
Oh.
There may be a few questions about the policy later on.
Okay.
Sure, thank you. We could certainly do that. If you'd like, we can take that up now since it's relative to that. So we'd have to move to the move down to rules and policy subcommittee. Is that the one mm-hmm. that you're referring
yep.
to?
There's a lot in that list.
What's that?
There's a lot on that list. I'm sorry, I'm interrupting you.
That's okay.
I'm just feeling like Lori Farkas is also here.
Well, we have one item concerning the student services director that I think will be somewhat briefer than the rules and policy. So maybe we can just stick with the agenda for now.
Okay.
So.
Thumbs up.
So he tried.
So I'm here to recommend extension of the Student Services Director contract to August 12, 2017. The current contract expires on June 30th. It was done to sort of sync up to fiscal year. However, In retrospect, that's a little short-sighted, because the worst possible time of year for a special ed director to start is at the beginning of summer program. When I was in that position, I always used to say, I can't wait till September when the principals come back, because you're essentially in the position of running a district smaller, but still all of the things that happen in a district more or less by yourself during that time. Also, it has a benefit for the employee with MTRS, will allow her to get credit for an additional year of service if she serves until August 12th.
So could I have a motion to amend the contract with the student services director, or to extend the contract of the student services director to August 12th, 2017?
I make a motion to extend the student services director contract through August 12th, 2017.
Second.
With gratitude for years of service.
Any discussion? All those in favor, please say aye.
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 Opposed? Any abstention? Okay. Thank you.
Thank you. I said I was sitting here, but you know, we've got you.
Okay. Okay. So now we will move down to the, we'll come back. Now we'll move down to the report of the Rules and Policies Subcommittee, and I'll turn it over to the chair, Ms. Fallon.
Can I take those in order? The first one's quick.
Sure.
So this is a first reading, and we will not be voting, which is fine, but I need you all to help me out to remember something that Mr. Moore brought to my attention earlier. The primary change that we're making to the rules of procedure is that under Section 2.2 of Standing Committees, we would like to change it to within 1 week following the first meeting in January following an election year, the chair shall appoint the various subcommittees. Each committee member shall be appointed to one of the three subcommittees. Members shall be informed of their subcommittee assignments as soon as possible. And Section 2.3 would be changed to the subcommittee shall each elect their own chairs at their first meeting of the calendar year. Meetings of all subcommittees shall each be called by the respective chairs. So this was a hope to limit the mayor's having to appoint different subcommittees every year, and give people an opportunity to really understand what they were doing in subcommittee, because the learning curve is a little steep. So that was the intent behind it. But what we didn't notice is that in Section 1.3, perhaps should have been changed to reflect that alignment, so that if someone, when this comes up for vote next month, will remember to amend that, that within 1 week following the first meeting in January following an election year, the first sentence should also be changed in Section 1.3. So that was the only change that we were suggesting to the rules of procedure. Next up, and I would like to say, it's clear we've met a bit more than usual, and we don't just meet in a bubble. There have been a lot of the administrators, teachers, and other experts that have offered us their expertise, insight, and helped us with most of these changes to policy. And so that's been really valuable, and I'd like to thank them for their time, and especially Laura Judd, who is so good about sitting through 2.5 hours of a meeting and coming up with one page of minutes. So I really appreciate that. So the change to the graduation requirements revised is primarily has to do with the curriculum committee's recommendations to change the requirements for social studies. But there's also a change in the last sentence where we reword students must have been enrolled in an approved public or independent school for at least 4 years after the completion of eighth grade with the final year at Northampton High School. And that's really just to make the wording a little bit clearer. But the social studies portion of it would be that for the class of 2021 and subsequent classes, three sequential social studies courses, three credits, which must be World History 1, World History 2, or the Honors AP European History equivalent, and then US History 2, or the AP equivalent. And Principal Lombardi made it very clear that it was the order that mattered, but it wasn't, you had to take a certain class in a certain year. And our recommendation was for that to be for the class of 2021, and I'm not sure if that's still the case. Yes?
Well, that's not what was presented.
That's tonight. Not what's presented. That's why I'm kind of baffled, and I kept looking at you quizzically. But
that was presented tonight.
No, I think
2020.
2020 was what was said. And our the subcommittee, when we met, we were very concerned about changing graduation requirements for a class that was already enrolled.
So, if I recall that conversation, there was really two things driving that concern. One was it legal? And clearly, if it was illegal, we wouldn't be doing it. We wouldn't be here. And I think that hurdle, we found that we can do that. Then I think the next hurdle was really more philosophically. At the school, we can handle class of 20 and 21. We can continue two levels. I think what it comes down to is that we know that on the old model, as Downey said, we weren't. Providing the education that we were expected to in regards to standards. Students are not getting the full boat of U.S. history. So we would recommend that we think, listen, it's worth making sure that students are getting the full breadth of U.S. history and world history. We do not think it's going to have a negative impact in regards to jamming anyone for graduation or having being able to access these classes. But we do think it's important that the class of 2020 have access to the full knowledge of U.S. history and world history. So that's why we were recommending that. And I think it's, you know, as someone mentioned at the last meeting, is that right? The class of 2020 is starting high school with an understanding that they have three credits of these three classes. I understand that. But is there something as educators that that isn't it our mission or duty to point out if they were getting a less than stellar or full educational components? I leave that to you.
I would love to know the superintendent where he stands on this. I feel like I spoke endlessly about this topic at our meeting. So, mm-hmm.
This one is a hard one for me. I really want to support the recommendation of the history department and the high school administration. I worry that if we change graduation requirements for the current students, that there will be concerns we hear afterwards. The only model we have for this, really, in my experience here, is the change in the Wellness 1 and Wellness 2 curriculum, which also impacted class of 2020 current freshmen, which we rolled out with a new group of freshmen, and everyone accepted that was legitimate. So, you know, I'm worried about rolling the dice on this.
I mean, again, how it's going to impact them is that their third choice will be. It will be World History 2, Honors, World History 2, AP. They're still going to take U.S. History. You know, our feeling is that, you know, if there are students, I think, that popped up and were adamant, if there were students that popped up and the remaining history, and for some reason they were adamant, I do not want to take World History 2, I do not want to take Honors History 2, nor AP. I think we'd have a conversation with them.
Dr. Baird. So I think you could flip that. So I think you could leave it the way it is with the class of 2021 and then highly encourage and really convince kids to take it. And then that would remedy this problem. I feel a little uncomfortable with kids who have already started. I think back to college days, you're like, nope, this was the catalog I started with. It doesn't matter if I'm like the 6 year in here. So that's where I'm sitting.
Yeah, and I would say I think the only problem with that is that just highly encouraging is as good as not saying anything. So I think you would say it would begin in 2021, class of 2021. If you wanted to try to figure out a way to create some room, and I don't know if this might be fine or it might just be an endless headache for the administration, would be to say it begins with the class of 2020. However, for only the class of 2020, they may be accepted from this requirement upon you know, basically convincing the administration that there will be a hardship to them.
You really want
to start the fact that it was just implemented this year. Something like that.
Yeah, I mean, I feel that, you know, we can't absorb those students. They're going to have to take a world history, a U.S. history. That's not changing. So you're really talking one class. And what's going to be on the board, things can be on the board, things are going to be off the board. So what's going to be off the board will be modern Europe, which is predominantly what many of sophomores take. So we're going to see that. The thought is that also having access to the AP Euro, we're going to see an increase of that, and having the honors world history too, that's going to get a lot of choices. So the amount of students that would really say, I'm not interested in world history too, I'm not interested in the honors of AP, we feel we can meet their needs with other electives, and we would work with them for that.
I think Elena had a comment.
So we don't want to get into we want to support our kids have a good education and a good educational experience, bottom line.
Just to be totally clear, the early modern that kids take in their freshman year, yes, that credit is still being honored?
Yep.
So absolutely, they wouldn't have to start at this like three-step program?
Oh, absolutely.
They would start at the second step?
Yep. So next year, their second option is they're going to come to course selections in about 8 weeks. It would be highly recommended from their history teachers. Depending on which what language we use, but they would be educated about a history for next year, and the next sequence would be world history too.
Okay, so they're
they're
not losing out on any credits. They are simply just, they still have to take two history courses. If they do, they have to take.
Yeah, and one of the two already is determined in the old requirement as U.S. history. So
okay. That's
still there.
So I'm not seeing like a huge shift because we haven't signed up for courses for next year yet, right? So we're not losing out on anything.
I think, just to be fair to the concerns, is that if there was, when you came in as a freshman, you might have, you know, seen the courses that you had to take, and you're like, okay, I need to take three maths, and the maths are IM 1, 2, and 3, or whatever, and you see the sciences. There could be some students that said, you know what, all right, I have to do early modern, I have to do U.S. history 1. I really want to take my third option as a history. I would like to take history of the Holocaust, World War II, and that would count as one of the three.
Now
they could take that, but it would be after the fact. And part of also the reason why people want this recommendation is that many times students are taking the World War II, the history courses, and they don't have the background information that things are being talked about in there. And so what we're really trying to do is set the stage, okay, this is the world history, this is the U.S. history where it fits in. Now we're going to do a World War II. Now we're going to do a Holocaust. Maybe at some point we'll have a Vietnam, but you're constantly drawing from other aspects of things coming on, and teachers are finding at times go back and reteach some things that kids didn't know about key historical events.
Dr. Provost, sorry. Thank you, Elena.
I'll just throw this question in to see if it helps at all. I would, thinking about Mr. Moore's suggestion about, you know, starting it with 2020, but allowing some sort of waiver or appeal process.
For those people.
Yeah.
I wonder if it would be better from your perspective to have that window defined so that you're not hearing appeals for the next 3 years. But say if you have an appeal, you know, you have till the end of the year to say, no, I had a plan or whatever.
Yeah, I think something like that, or I don't think we're going to be talking about a lot of students. Mm-hmm. And, you know, we have, you know, from history of the Islam, World War II, microeconomics, women's studies, mm-hmm, psychology, social, I mean, there's electives there that would, really believe, meet the needs of the students if they chose not to do this path.
Ms. Fallon.
So I just want to make my position on this clear to the whole committee. I want nothing more than to be able to support you in this, mm-hmm, and I appreciate how much work and thought went into it, and from an educational standpoint, I fully support it, but I keep coming back to philosophically, I oppose it. And once you start making a window, it's no longer a requirement. If it's a requirement, you don't have exceptions to that level. Do you know what I'm saying? So I feel like either...
Just to clarify, because we had a big, long discussion about that, you oppose doing it on 2020.
Yes, 2020. I'm totally supporting the way we've revised the policy for 2021. But to make it apply to those students who have already entered in under these expectations, I mean, as the mother of four kids, you don't change the rules of the game after the game starts, even if it hadn't occurred to you, like, wow, this is really dangerous, we need to impose more rules. It doesn't go over well, you know, like kids don't appreciate you changing the rules of the game in the middle of it. Same thing with a marriage contract or any other contract. You can't tell the rental car agency, I signed your contract, but I decided that having a flat tire and a missing side mirror are actually okay. Like, I'm just saying, I get that there's no legal precedent preventing it, but I don't know that it's the right thing to do.
I hear that, and I just, again, I want to just make sure I'm advocating for my history department. We think that, again, and I'll support whatever decision, clearly, and we'll do it, and to support our needs, but we really think it's, as the educators, it is our responsibility to put out there, ensure that when students leave Northampton High School, we have provided them the absolute best education. We really think that certain things are worth fighting for or advocating for, and to ensure that people, a class is getting another, you know, 130, 140 years of history and knowledge is important. I think, if anything, with the recent election, about the, how do you think, how do you analyze, having information about the world you live in is even more important. And we want to make sure that students have that. But again, that we have to choose what is that we want to stand for and what is that we want to debate about, I guess.
Ms. Burnham?
I want to say, I mean, I was in this meeting, and I was so impressed by the presentation of the history department and the dedication, and I know that Ms. Fallon is as well. As a parent in this school district, I feel, I have to say, and maybe I'm going to get like a huge amount of emails back, and that's great because it's information, and you've been on the school board longer than I have. I feel like this is not a contract. We enter our kids, things change, curriculum changes. And I feel like the curriculum changes we take very seriously. It's not willy-nilly. It's really thought out by our departments. And I feel as a parent that if there's a curriculum change that my child needs to go through while both of my kids are going through the Northampton schools, that that's something that I need to go with. That actually life is not that predictable. We have had a massive change in our country, and our curriculum and everything that we talk about, we're trying to address that curriculum through our curriculum. Everything that we've talked about, sanctuary schools and anti-racism, I feel like that is actually a huge part of what we're talking about. And I feel like we're really adding something to the students for Northampton, and somehow it's getting turned into a conversation about what they're gonna lose out on. And I welcome, if parents out there are really mad at me for saying this, it's information, so send it to me, and I appreciate it.
But I think that's a great thing, because it is what they're going to gain. And if you go back to the conversation you had earlier about racism, and I don't even want to jump into that, but in regards to students leaving, in regards to having any understanding of some of our relationship with slavery and issues of racism in our country, if our students leave at 1877, there's a lot that's being missed in conversations about some of those topics.
But that's being changed. Like, the requirement is U.S. history, so now they're going to get U.S. 2. So that's,
But they're also getting,
no matter what happens for 2020 or 21, that's the history they're going to get, because it wasn't a U.S. 1 or U.S. 2 requirement. So they're going to get 1877 on. It's one class. I really agree with Laura that since all the freshmen took the U.S., the World One.
Mm-hmm. No, yes, early modern.
They all took early modern.
So they all took that already.
Right, and they need to take a U.S.
World History.
The U.S. history, they're taking it.
Two,
that's
yep.
not going to change, because we're only going to be offering the U.S. 2. Yeah. So it really is the few students, you said, who might not want to take another class of World 2, modern World 2. It's those students that we're saying, you came in
And we didn't. We said, you don't have to take this. And they're going to get that same lovely, wonderful teaching from your department in psych or micro or US 1 if it's still offered as an elective or not. So they won't get the slavery. Another sociology, Holocaust, all these other things they could take to get that great teaching. If it's that few students, I think changing the requirements isn't worth it. That's me. I like the changes you've made. I think it's great. And I think starting with 2021 is an ethical thing to do.
Mr. Reed?
So I think, because we did have a long conversation about this in subcommittee, and I think we all really like the change. Mm-hmm. And it's great, and it's going to be great for the students. And I think what the discussion boiled down to after many hours was whether we do this in 2020 to the class of 2020 or the class of 2021. Mm-hmm. So I was under the impression that we were going to, and there are good arguments for both. One, your argument for 2020 is they get this better instruction sooner. The concern with that move is who knows what kind of pushback we could get or whatever. So I was under the impression that we were going to, at some point, hear what the cost would be, or I don't mean literally cost, but yeah. What would the problem be of putting it off to 2021? And the sort of strong encouragement for 2020 and then yeah. requirement for 2021. And you had very reasonable concerns about having to sort of do two yep. different curricula at the same time.
So, yes, and so as I think I said at the beginning of tonight, we can do both. You know, after our last meeting, I sat down with Ms. Todd Hunter. We looked at our course offerings. We looked at current class. Again, some classes are going to come off the board. You know, kids will be able to choose. Well, part of their menu for choice is going to be world history too.
Sort of put it really.
You know, so it's, you know, on their menu of things that they can choose for a sophomore, what they'll be looking at to choose will be honors, world history two, world history two, modern.
Sort of put it in really
so we concrete. Can handle these both, and we said
to make it really concrete, what would the problem be for you to have as the policy that's here before us, which says 2021? What would be the problem for you?
It's no problem.
If you went 2021.
Okay.
There is no structural. There is no, you know, course offering thing that we can predict. You know, like anything else, there might be something. Numbers that we're not seeing, but Ms. Todd Hunter and I looked at our current course offerings, things that are going to be coming off the board, you know, what's going to be going on the board for classes. We did not see or think that this would be anything substantial that would negatively impact course offerings for history. It really fundamentally comes down to is the educators feeling that it is the more educationally sound to try to get students to have the most robust, you know, education, understanding world and U.S. history, and that relationship. And again, that's where they think that, you know, that it's, and I think Ilana said, I don't know how impactful it's going to be. I don't really see that the pushback. I think when we did the math, that was a different change. It was hard to conceptualize when you go from an algebra geometry format to an integrated. It's like, well, what is that? You know, I think that when you explain, you know, history, people understand history in terms of we've all had history. We're not changing history. We're just ensuring that you're going to get all components of it.
Ms. Pisansky.
I guess I just wanted to say that I agree with Ms. Burnham. I don't think it's such a big deal to change the curriculum for this current freshman class. And maybe I'm not seeing it, but the rules change all the time. The curriculum changes all the time. I can think of five things that happen at Jackson Street just in the last 2 years of my daughter's education there. Things change at JFK. Things change at the high school. It's a small thing, I realize, but juniors aren't allowed to go out to lunch anymore at the high school. I don't know of any freshmen who left or sophomores who left the high school because they can't go out to lunch anymore when they become a junior. I mean, things change. I think this, if we believe this is educationally sound, I like Mr. Moore's idea of that we could add in maybe an exemption for through the end of the year if you can come and make your case, the administration will hear you out. And an exemption could be made, but I have a, I would find it hard to believe that you would have, maybe you'd have a handful. I don't know. I can't really imagine. It seems to me the gain is just so far as that outweighs whatever the loss might possibly be that I just feel like we should just move ahead and make the change. And like you said, maybe I'm missing something, but there'll be this huge lashback. But I just really find it hard to believe. We change the rules all the time in education because we have to, because of budget reasons. There's a million reasons. And I think this is a good, sound reason. I heard Ms. Todd Hunter present at the NHS PTO meeting in December on this, you know, so I wasn't in the curriculum subcommittee, but there are really good, sound reasons. I feel like the history department believes in it. We have a great history department at the high school, and I think we should just go ahead and do it.
I kind of want to voice like two different things. First of all, I think that as someone who is in their junior year and quickly running out of slots to take classes, as a student, I would be concerned in losing a slot for an elective, because I know like I am dying to take history of the Islamic world and Black history and all of these amazing electives, and I am concerned about freshmen who are already planning which electives to take, that they might not have room for that elective once they start adding in AP classes and Smith classes and all that. But the other thing is that I know, as someone who's currently in AP Euro and took AP US, it is so wonderful to have that continuity in the curriculum you're learning and looking at a whole span of years at once, as opposed to like broken up semesters of history. And I think I really appreciate the work that the history department is doing to make that curriculum more streamlined. And I really want the freshman class to get that chance to have that. So that's my piece.
We're not trying, you know, if there was, you know, a student that really had some of that, I don't see why we would say no. You know, but I think that some things are worth pushback, I suppose, you know, and I think that we're saying this is what is sound for you and that this type of education, I think we put that out there. But if there's someone that their pushback is, I hear you, but I really want to take that class, I don't feel that we would sit there and say no to that, because I think we're going to get, you know, many students going to say yes. I get this. Yeah, my sophomore year, I want that honors class. I know there's going to be a contingent that that's going to be the fact that they have that on the radar. I'm going for that. There's going to be the students are going to go for the AP, and for the students that were taking modern world history, I think they're going to be going for world history too.
Okay.
But so, again, like I said, we can do either one. So it's your choice, your decision.
So this is a
first
reading.
Thank you, God.
So.
I thought okay. I knew what I wanted, and you all present very compelling arguments.
I just,
but that's good, because that gives us time to hear from the public, and
yes.
Rebecca and I get a...
Yeah.
Right. Yeah. Before we're going to get filled up, we'll go and talk to you.
Yep. Maybe I'll get emails, too, so we can share.
It's information. Yeah.
And then the second reading discussion will be very short, I imagine.
That's right.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Everything is short.
Okay. Thank you, everybody.
Thank you.
Okay. This is also a first reading of policy IHBGA, home education students and the attainment of Northampton High School credits. The changes that we were hoping to make are to clarify that the high school doesn't acknowledge or award credit for homeschool courses, and that the district doesn't offer any credential for students in homeschool programs. And so it changes the word course catalog to program of studies to reflect what we call it, and it takes out a lot of the language for all these different ways of attaining Northampton High School credits. And then the final thing that it does is clarify that at any point before their 21st birthday, rather than in their high school career, a home education student may enroll and thereby accumulate credits towards a Northampton High School diploma or a certificate of completion. Did I miss anything? No comments, questions?
We're played out.
Okay. Well, good. All right. And I'm going to try and push through another first reading. The final one is the first reading of Policy JF, School Admissions Revised. This makes Policy JF more succinct. We took out approximately 6 paragraphs. And it also is consistent with what we already discussed tonight about undocumented students. And then the final thing we did was strike the legal references that no longer pertained and the cross-references that we to policies that we do not have. So that is a policy we would vote on next month at the second reading.
Okay.
That's it.
Any discussion or any questions about any of these policies?
Oh, wow.
Oh.
In a couple of these things we've done tonight, it seems like we talk about, it seems like there's sort of special rules for homeless students that we don't always acknowledge or address in some of these policies, where they don't have to actually establish their residency and they don't have to, you know, do any of those things. And we don't say that in our policies. And I don't know, you know, I know that's sort of an exception, it has its own rule, but I don't know if it would be maybe appropriate to acknowledge that.
With
a sentence in the policy.
Wait, I'm sorry, to acknowledge what?
Okay, so all children, basically, I guess maybe that's it, certain children who do not reside, or, you know, homeless kids are in a strange category.
We did cross-reference that.
But they're not, okay.
That's cross-reference, the admission of homeless students.
Okay, good.
Is that enough, or do you want
maybe
actual
language? That's enough. I don't know. I just felt like in there, I don't know what I'm just, it's one of those things that bothered me about this when I read it. You know, sort of like, it looks like it's talking about school choice, and it looks like it's talking about kids who live here. But, you know, you'd have to go down to the footnote.
So you want to be more specific in
name? I think I would like something like that, but I don't know what the specific language would be. Yeah.
Between now and second reading, perhaps.
Yes, maybe I will have.
You can wordsmith something and send it to the chair.
Okay.
So now we've completed the report of the Rules and Policy Subcommittee. We'll move back up to the regular agenda order, and we have returned to item letter J, which is the discussion of a search for a new director of student services.
As you all discussed earlier tonight, we will be losing our director of student services in August. This is one of the positions that's hired directly by the school committee, and so I think it would be appropriate to have some school committee input on the search process to report back to the full committee. And furthermore, I was thinking that given specific roles of members on the committee, it would make sense if the liaison to the special ed PAC and the vice chair would be willing to serve on that committee with me.
I'm willing to serve.
Thank you. So we'll get started.
Okay. Excellent. Okay, so the next item on the agenda, item K, is a vote on a proposed job description, Director of Health, Safety, and Equity Programs. I'll turn it over back to Dr. Provost.
Believe it or not, this is an attempt to streamline the job description. The current job description is 4 full pages long, so this is chopping off about 25% of it. So that is really eliminating duplications in the current job description, where the same job or a very similar function is listed multiple times on the job description. The other substantive change about this is removing the word education. The current job description says Director of Health Education, Safety and Equity Programs, and references to health education within the job description, because health education is a curricular responsibility and it falls under the purview of the curriculum director. This job is related to providing health services, so it just clarifies that.
Sure. I had a question, I apologize for my ignorance if I ask something about a nurse that I may already or I should know. I was looking under the education and experience, and it talks about must maintain certification in CPR, including AED training. I know, like, when I renew my certifications, I have to get the first aid certification as well. Does that belong here, or is it the?
We just carried over the same certifications that are required in the current job description. We really didn't have a discussion of first aid training. I could look into that if you.
I'm pretty sure if you're already a licensed health professional,
I try to start off with my.
Yeah, because my wife is a physician and she has to do CPR training, but she doesn't have to do first aid training because they assume that part of it's already embedded in your professional degree. So I was assuming that's what it's about.
Good enough for me.
Yeah.
Again, I don't know how this works. Who hires all the school nurses, and what is the level of sort of interaction between this person and all of the principals?
This person hires all the school nurses and supervises the nurses at their school sites. The person sits on the alt team, so they meet at least every other week with all the principals, and is in contact with principals for medical issues that arise in the schools. Person is also responsible in communication with principals a great deal around substitute nurse coverage.
All right, Ms. Fallon.
I was just questioning, and now I can't find it in the document, but the reference to their responsibilities as coalition leader for the Northampton Prevention Coalition, because that's grant dependent. Is that grant guaranteed to be renewed every year?
The grant is not guaranteed to be renewed every year. But
so you would have to change the language if that grant funding stopped?
Yeah.
But you would do it then, not now?
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Yeah, I'll make a motion on the job description, Director of Health, Safety, and Equity Programs.
Second.
Further questions or discussions about this? Okay, all those in favor, please say aye.
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 Opposed? Any abstentions? Okay, so now we will skip past L, which we've already completed, and we'll move down to letter M. This is a vote to accept a gift from the JFK PTO. And Ms. Walczak?
Yes, as part of some of the changes we've made with the gifts, we're trying to bring the larger PTO gifts to your attention as well as to the public attention. We've done that previously with the high school, and we have two more tonight. The first one is from the JFK PTO in the amount of just under $2,400. There's a listing attached, I believe, to each of your backup that shows document cameras, busing, licenses for software, AV equipment, and program expenses that this would cover for a number of classes at JFK.
Do you want to just describe the second one as well? And
Together?
Perhaps we could take them as a group if that's okay.
The second one is from the Leeds PTO. Again, it's just under $2,400 as listed on your thing. And there is also attachments there showing there are some privacy shields for computer stations, some standing desk, cameras, and a number of instructional supplies and furniture that is being purchased with this $2,400 gift from that PTO.
Make a motion to accept the gifts, JFK PTO, in the amount of $2,392.84, and fall teacher grants, and the Leeds PTO, $2,360.67 through the PTO Gives program.
Okay. Any further discussion? All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Any abstentions? Okay. And then, Ms. Walczak, you want to just go right into the...
Yep. Budget report. Again, the budget continues to be tight. We haven't had any miracles happen. We can hold out hope for mild weather that will help us this winter. One of the new things that has come up that's beginning to stand out as we go further into the year is that there is a new deficit identified in our Lower Pioneer Valley tuition category. We had a second student move in after school started. We had one last year, which I think is the first time Northampton's had a student going to Lower Pioneer Valley, which is basically a half-day career tech program, because typically the kids go to Smith Volk. When they move in and they're already at that program, they're generally wanting to stay and get allowed to stay. So we had one last year that we budgeted for. After school started this year, we had a second move in. So you've got tuition and transportation costs to West Springfield. So currently that
Lower Pioneer Valley count is looking at a deficit of about $18,000. In addition to that, the other deficits we're seeing are things that we've pointed out in the past, some of those in the special ed area. And we're continuing to keep an eye and make cuts in the budget wherever we can to cover those special ed expenses. We already talked and you approved the budget transfer for the realignment of the water and sewer accounts. And then the last item are the additional gifts that have come. There were no gifts that were accepted this month directly by the superintendent, but we have quite a few that were accepted by the principals from the PTO. These would be the smaller gifts that were under $1,000. Ryan Road accepted two gifts for storage bins for Chromebooks and lockdown door magnets for a total value of $944. And then Leeds had seven or eight different donations. Some of it came from the Florence Bank Customer Choice Awards, and the rest of it came from PTO funds. That totaled a total of $1,235 for Leeds, and it included a number of classroom supplies, pretty much classroom supplies going to various teachers for that amount.
I had a question on the pupil transportation item on the munis. It's at like close to 95% expended.
Yes.
So is the majority of that already paid forward into the year, or is it, I mean, since we're only halfway through the year, yeah, and we're almost 100% expended, should we expect that to grow in a huge deficit there?
Most likely. It's special. So the 95% represents what we've paid and what we've encumbered. So for our big bus transportation, we do a purchase order for the entire year. We've only paid for the first 4 months or possibly 5 months of school, but it's all encumbered, so it's all accounted for in here. What's really driving this is special ed transportation. We're currently looking at a deficit as of last week of $59,000 for special ed transportation. We have a surplus in the homeless transportation, so we're kind of crossing our fingers that one will help with the other. But and we're also getting reductions in the large bus transportation as well as special ed from fuel adjustments. Fuel is still down from the base that was built into the contract, so each month we're receiving credits for fuel that will hopefully help to reduce that deficit too. But it's as special ed tuition is well over budget, special ed transportation goes hand in hand, and that's also well over budget.
Dr. Baer. So that prompted a follow-up question, somewhat related, but transportation for homeless students. So I remember us having a discussion that the change has gone into effect, I think, in January. So have we seen a change in how that's been in operation?
We've seen some. I don't know if I can put a value on it right now with some of the foster care placements. Yeah. We've seen some changes there, and we've seen one with it was a special ed circumstance where we ended up becoming responsible for the whole cost rather than 50% of the cost that we've had in the past. So we're seeing an impact. I don't have a financial cost to put on that yet.
But if I remember correctly, there was some discussion that like social workers may be having to drive students, but it doesn't seem like operationally that it has started, or I doubt will start, but.
Right. Memorandum that came out last year said that was one of the many options districts could consider.
Yeah.
But, you know, social workers typically don't have excess capacity to be driving kids around to school.
Did you have more?
I just had a question in regards to circuit breaker funds reimbursement, and if any of that would come into play with the higher costs, and maybe for new members on the board, a quick explanation of what that might mean.
Sure, because somebody on the board last year that came on asked me why we were talking about electricity, and it went right over my head because I was around when circuit breaker funding started. Circuit breaker funding probably kicked in 7 or 8 years ago, and it was a way to give communities money back to help bridge the gap, which is probably the connection to electrical, between what the state estimates the average cost of a special ed child is and some of the costs for the higher, more expensive students that we see. So the state each year sets the average based on the state numbers they see, and it's in the vicinity of around $42,000. So the communities are expected to pick up the first $42,000 on any special ed student. And then if you have a child who costs more than that, which most of your out-of-districts do, and some of your in-district students do if they have a lot of one-to-one services, there's a very complicated process the special ed department goes through to justify all those costs, goes into the state for review, and eventually you get back. The law is up to 75% reimbursement. I don't think they've ever funded more than 72%. But we get that money back. It goes into the circuit breaker revolving account that we'll talk about through the budget process. our goal has been what we take in this year to use next year and plan on that in the budget, because if we plan on using it the year it comes in and a child moves mid-year and we've planned on that cost, it could throw the budget off. So as with school choice, we plan what we take in this year to expend next year. We actually have been having a number of discussions in the past week or so with the Director of Special Ed, Student Services, and she believes that we're going to be eligible for what the state calls extraordinary relief, which is another component of the circuit breaker program. If your special ed expenses exceed 125% of what your claim was the prior year, you can put an application in for extraordinary relief, and we probably wouldn't hear until May or June. But it looks like right now, based on a couple of move-in students we've had recently, that we will be eligible to put that claim in. We've had one conversation with the Department of Ed trying to lay the groundwork that we really should qualify for that additional assistance. So the state will be announcing the application process, they said, within the next week or two, and then we'll probably have until March. You basically have to submit your expenses by child now that you would typically be doing in July. So good or bad, it moves the work up, but then it's out of the way for July.
Dr. Provost and then Ms. Fallon.
I just wanted to clarify one thing from your answer that I wasn't sure exactly clear. They're both reimbursement programs, which means the district has to spend the money first and then is reimbursed. In the traditional circuit breaker, the reimbursement comes in the fiscal year following the year that the district spends the money. In the extraordinary relief scenario, districts receive a portion of the money in the same year they're spending the money.
Ms. Fallon.
I was just curious, is that a fully funded program, or is that like a...
Subject to appropriation.
It is subject to appropriation.
By the Creighton General Court.
So, yeah. So
that's why it's never reached 75.
There may not be that money.
Well, when the legislature appropriated circuit breaker funding for this year, one of the things the Department of Ed does, and I'm not sure how they get the number, but they take a portion of that money and they set it aside for extraordinary relief. So when they do the initial funding to us, we might get 68 or 70%, even though the legislation says 75. They then look at what they get for claims under extraordinary relief and how much they award. What's happened a few years is they haven't had to award all of that money, so then they throw the balance back into the fund and they notify us in June that instead of getting 70%, we're going to get 71%. So they do set money aside at the beginning of the fiscal year, knowing these claims are coming at the end of the year.
Okay.
It's one of the perennially underfunded accounts, mm-hmm. like charter school reimbursement, like regional transportation, like, you know, just...
And I will note that whereas your circuit breaker in your house cuts off 100% of the electricity.
Yeah.
In Boston, they have circuit breakers that only cut off 70%, so the 30% that's left over can burn down your district.
Apparently.
So
yes.
We knew there was an electricity connection.
It's great PR. You know, they do a great job. Mm-hmm.
So, any other questions about the business manager report, the business report, personnel report?
Yep, short for December, mid-year. We had two hires that are listed for you, one separation, and four retirements. And we probably should recognize the retirements because some of these are long-term employees. Maura Stampa, who was a special ed teacher at Jackson School. Joni Kinner, who was a district physical therapy assistant. Gail Terranova, who was the long-term high school librarian. And Angelo Roto, who was our director of innovative instruction and technology. These are all positions that did retire during the month of December.
We'll now move to the superintendent's report.
Thank you. As you may recall from your NPS All email account, I've been involved in recent days with a discussion about best ways to honor teachers for the important work they do. This was stimulated by the nomination process for the Pioneer Valley Excellence in Teaching Awards, a program that is very highly valued by our teachers. In the midst of these discussions, I received a very unexpected email from someone whose life has definitely been profoundly and positively impacted by teachers from Northampton High School, who's chosen to honor them in his own way. So Monday night, I received an email from Rabbi Joseph Prouser, who's an alumnus from Northampton High School, class of 1979. He currently leads a congregation in Franklin Lakes, New Jersey, and serves on the faculty of the Academy for Jewish Religion in Yonkers, New York. Like most academics, he publishes, and he contacted me to let me know that he had recently published a new paper and that he had dedicated it to two of his former teachers from Northampton High. The paper is entitled Notre Dame de Paris, Victor Hugo's Midrash on the Book of Esther. It's also an opportunity for me to learn a new vocabulary word, so I can tell you what midrash is after.
It's not a rash in your mid.
The two teachers that he dedicated the paper to were his two high school French teachers, Vincent Fartelot and Jacques Lau. And the postscript to his paper reads, "This article is dedicated with gratitude to the memory of Messrs. Jacques Lau and Vincent Fartelot, my earliest teachers of French language and literature, gifted educators, and exemplars of personal character. On peut continuer à tout temps l'étude, mais non pas le collage." And so I'll apologize to my high school French teacher for hacking the quote. And I will also ask Barbara Bitgood, if she's watching, to please have mercy on me. But I would translate that as, "You can always learn, but not always in school." Which I think is an appropriate quote for the paper. As it turns out, I may be getting a chance to practice my French soon, and we may all be getting our opportunities to practice our French soon, because I learned today that Catholic Charities has been pinged. Another new vocabulary word. I learned yesterday that ping is a verb which means to transmit an electronic request to receive an individual or group of individuals who's been cleared to enter the U.S. The timeline from ping to arrival is expected to be 30 to 45 days, which will give us some time to assess the needs of the incoming students, because we'll get some of the packet at the time of the pinging. Once families arrive, they'll start a process of medical evaluation and re-examination. They have 2 weeks during which they'll be inoculated or re-inoculated before they're cleared to enter the schools. So based upon this timeline, I would expect the first students to enroll in classes in Northampton sometime in March. And finally, I would just like to call everyone's attention to the two community meetings that will take place this month to discuss the results of the Q sort. Meetings have been scheduled Wednesday, January 18th, and Tuesday, January 24th. Both meetings will take place at JFK Middle School in the library and begin at 7 p.m. Child care and Spanish language interpretation services will be provided. I've prepared a provisional interpretation of the results, but I would like to check its accuracy and impact by discussing the interpretation with a diverse group representing a broad cross-section of our stakeholders. So if you're listening tonight, and if you can attend either meeting, I sincerely hope you'll come and lend your voice to the discussion.
Can you repeat those days and times?
Sure. It's Wednesday, January 18th, and Tuesday, January 24th. Both meetings are at 7 p.m. in the JFK Middle School Library.
A midrash.
A midrash is a biblical commentary.
Okay.
Thank you.
Okay. We don't have any new business. Future business and meeting dates. January 31st, Tuesday, January 31st, here in the community room, the Joint School Committee City Council budget meeting at 7 p.m. Then the school committee meeting, February 9th, 2017, 7:15 p.m. here in the community room. Rules and Policy Subcommittee meets on February 15th in the superintendent's office, 3:30 p.m. And then our second school committee meeting for the month of February is February 23rd, 2017, 7:15 p.m. in the JFK community room. We'll now move to the final item on our agenda, which is a request for an executive session, and I'll ask the vice chair to make the motion.
Okay, I'll make the motion for a request for an executive session in the JFK principal conference room under Massachusetts General Law Open Meeting Law, Chapter 30A, Section 21A3, to discuss strategy with respect to collective bargaining, NACE, whereas an open session would have a detrimental effect and further details would compromise the reason for going into executive session.
Is there a second?
Second.
Second. I would now ask the clerk to call the roll. And this is a yes or no vote to move into executive session.
Yes. Yes. Yes.
Yes.
Yes. Yes. Now I need to announce to the public that we will be moving into an executive session because to discuss these matters in open session would be detrimental to the school committee's bargaining position. I also want to advise the public that we will be adjourning from executive session. We will not return to open session. So with that, we'll now move into executive session.